porch on the front, you know. It won't be intruding into the parking spaces at all. I think she's got, you guys have a plan or somewhat of a sketch for that. There's gonna be, we pretty much got the whole inside, all new electrical plumbing, all new insulation, because the building is definitely not insulated that well. The exterior is gonna be all hobby vinyl, hobby windows and doors, basically Trex deck, stonework on the front, on the pillars, stuff like that. As far as even the overhead electrical, we got a permit through the town of Reading to come down the pole. We're gonna do all underground electrical, come in the right side of the building, which would be nice. You won't, once it's completed, the building's gonna look nice. You won't see all the overhead wiring and cables. Other than that, that's pretty much it. Jesse has the samples that I submitted.
Yeah, so, here you can show the board.
Basically, that's gonna be the color of the vinyl siding. The windows and doors are all a white hobby, standard window and door.
I included a scanned copy of this in your packet.
It's definitely gonna be a big improvement once,
yeah.
We're excited to get started on it.
We do have some current photos here of what the property looks like now.
Believe it or not, like, from the building to the edge of the driveway there, or the parking spaces, it's over 8 feet, like 8 feet, 1 inch. So the porch is only coming out 5 feet.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll still give us 3 feet of landscape in front of there, so it doesn't look like pavement decking. So we plan on doing landscaping there. And even on the other side, where I have an arrow to the left of the door there, we're gonna cut that out as well and put some plantings there. And I don't know, you have a picture of the back.
You were planning on doing something here.
Yeah, we're gonna be coming down this pole here and doing all underground. I got permission from the guy to the right. I actually know him. And the meters and everything are gonna be coming into to the right side of the building. So that's the back there. Actually, a couple of those dead rotted trees are already taken out, and eventually we're gonna stick abrevieties all along that, the whole back there. Clean that whole thing out. I think right now there's bamboo there. Stuff grows like wildfire. It's already like 8 feet tall.
Well, it's grass.
Yeah, that's a button in the back Davis lot. So we're gonna put abrevieties all along the back there and probably continue to the right once we get all that out of there. Something like that, yeah.
What's happening there right now? Is there any business in there?
Right now, there's just pretty much John Durant, and he's part-time. I think he's got a dealer license for 2 or 3 cars. And I don't know what his intentions are. Just from talking to him, I'm not speaking for him, but I don't see him being there much longer, so. Which is good for us, because we want to go in there and gut the whole thing and do everything, so it actually works out. So.
I couldn't tell from the, I didn't have a chance to go onto the town website. Who are your next door neighbors on each side?
There's a condo building to the right, and I know Peter Collins manages it.
Okay.
And I actually know Peter, he's a friend of mine, so.
It's like two down from the car wash.
Yeah,
right?
The car, it's right across from the Burger King. It's a little house, that little.
Oh, okay. It's in, because I couldn't get a, I don't have a good sense of the street numbers on that piece of
Main Street. Directly across from Burger King.
Okay.
Yep.
Drop the guy right there.
Sure enough.
There we go.
Wow.
Okay, yeah.
So
yeah, that's, I mean, that's the classic Cape.
Yeah,
two
it's
bedroom.
Gonna look, basically that, actually the picture you had back there, Jesse, from the hobby catalog, is pretty much the same color vinyl and windows and doors. I think you had it on the screen. Yeah, that was on the screen, yeah, originally, a few minutes ago. Basically, that's the color and the shingles and the windows and everything.
Right.
It's ironic, but and even the stoneware is going to be similar to that. If anybody wants that awning, just, you know, feel free.
What is, what's your, the plan for the signage, so?
Well, right now, it's staying the way it is until we figure out what's going to go in there. And, I mean, we're not going to propose signs on the building or nothing like that, so. If someone wants to move in, they'll have to stay in the footprint of the existing signage, which is fine with me.
So So currently, this is a little bit older street view, so currently, if you guys aren't familiar with it or recall what it is, John Durant has an additional sign that sort of below the, where the blue is, he actually has something that's.
Yeah, it's in between the two poles.
Right.
And then there's two separate panels.
Yeah, I think you had a picture of all the electrical coming across there, two and one of them that I saw.
Well, underground electric is a big feature.
Yeah, it's. That's pretty neat.
I mean, coincidentally, I own a house on the Cape which has exactly the same shape and exactly the same chimney and exactly the same place.
Yeah.
And one of the issues is that there's nowhere to connect the wires.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I figured, you know what, once we do the whole thing over, you know, now it kind of blends in because the whole thing's an eyesore. You know, but once we do it all over, it's, you know, it'd be nice to bring everything on the right side of the building too. All the meters would be out of the way. And,
right.
So. Other than that, I don't know if you have any questions about it.
The only question I have is, the decision says that the existing porches are proposed to be painted white. I don't know what that means. Keeping the porches in place.
No, no, there's really no porches there. There's only two entrances. Maybe the Trex deck railing or something might have been proposed white.
Oh, yeah, the yeah, we can scratch that.
I'm just curious, did you use any of the South Main Street design standards for any of this? Are you familiar with that?
No.
No? Okay. I was just curious.
Yeah.
Well, going for the underground electric is one of those.
Okay.
So.
Good.
Yeah, when I met with Chris at the counter, I didn't specifically go through the guidelines themselves, but talked to him about landscaping and those sort of things that the CPDC would want to see.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where he did provide some additional material for the landscaping.
Yeah, I think it'd be nice. There's oil in there now. We're, I already contacted the National Grid. They're going to come out and we're going to do gas there, get rid of the oil.
Mm-hmm. This is good. We've got a condition highlighted in the version that I'm looking at for landscaping.
So I was not sure if we wanted to specifically condition what he's proposing. We don't have an actual landscape plan. It's sort of more ideas. So not sure how we wanted to go about that. You did mention arborvitaes along.
Yeah, I was just thinking along the back that'll cover up that fence and give even the neighbors some privacy there. And then,
are you planning on going sort of the whole length of the property line?
I think that would be nice. We'll dress it up.
And then what about anything up here along this side property line?
I mean, those right now, there's bushes there with mulch and stuff. I mean, it's kind of half theirs, half mine.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm sure we could come to site, but I think by just the whole appearance of the new building and stuff we're going to do in front of the whole thing, it's kind of going to wrap it around even to the left side there.
Hmm.
You can add some color and stuff. I mean, when that time comes, we can, you know, we get the layout of where the stuff's going. A friend of mine's a landscaper. He can come down and kind of do a.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know nothing about it. I know I have varieties, so that's it.
Well,
some hanging plants on the porch.
Tell me you can come back for that. He can deal with you if you want.
So we can certainly put in a condition for the rear property, because that is, I believe that's residential back there. We certainly would appreciate that extra buffering, certainly in the back. And then.
Well, I mean, the statement he's got in the proposal is sufficiently general, and it says cleaning up the entire side and back of the building area, and you know, something generic of providing the landscaping to, along the borders. I mean, I don't think we have to be very specific.
Farmer's porch and the side, in front of the side entry, or what would, this area, right?
Yeah, that left side, Dan, is gonna, we're gonna saw cut that out too, just put some plants. Kind of wrap, make it wrap it around. The only other thing, I don't know if I submitted on the plan, but, you know, we're doing the stonework around the foundation and the pillars and all that. We'll probably do the same type of stone, but if we reface that whole chimney to make it all match, and the best chimney would stick out like a sore thumb, but I think it's gonna look nice.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there's, a brick chimney is a brick chimney.
Yeah. The red's gonna clash with my vinyl, though. No. I think, is it the only plan there, kind of? It's just kind of the chimney there. I thought the architect put it on the thing, but.
Showing more of the brick, though, I think.
Yeah.
I don't think you want to add that as a condition if he finds out he has more.
No, it would be a finding.
Okay.
Yeah.
But.
I mean, I think after the whole project's said and done, maybe, I don't know, maybe it's in the fall or beginning of the spring, we're just gonna reseal coat and probably redo the lines and everything. Maybe complete, you know?
Sure. Anything else? John?
Move that the CPDC approve the minor site plan review decision for the project at 360 Main Street as amended.
Second.
Yeah.
Wonder that.
Well, from the draft. I mean, it's.
Okay, I mean, it's not, it's never official.
Okay. Move that we approve the decision.
Check.
All those in favor?
Okay.
All right.
You're done.
Good luck.
You don't want, I know you don't want this.
You can have it back.
You want it for your cave house?
No.
It's nice.
Not quite big enough.
All right, thanks.
All right. Next up on our agenda, minor modification request to the PUD special permit, Johnson Woods Development Phase 2. Jesse, you want to provide us with a brief overview?
Sure. So, Johnson Woods Phase 2, there are proposing some modifications to a couple items within the proposal. They're proposing to relocate one affordable unit from 30 Taylor Drive to 16 Taylor Drive. They want to, in place of that unit, create sort of a common area, and I'll let the applicant go into detail if you have questions about that.
They're also proposing to move the single family unit that was on Green Meadow Drive over to Talbot Lane and do sort of a rearranging of those units. And I can pull up the plan to show that a little bit easier. And then in place of that single family home, they're proposing to construct a new 3-car carriage house, garage, and 2 additional spaces off the roadway. So we did have some preliminary discussions with DHCD in regards to moving the affordable unit. They don't have any problems with it as long as the planning board approves it. They will in fact have to go back and formalize it by amending the regulatory agreement. So I have drafted the condition to indicate that. And then the town engineer also provided a memo in regards to the proposed changes. And that should be in your packets and your dust packets. So I will let the applicant go into a little bit more detail and I'll pull up the plans as well.
Good evening, my name is Bill Berisher, I'm from Hayes Engineering. This is our 6-month pilgrimage on Staunton Woods. Jesse had asked, as long as we have this planned up, Jesse had asked kind of where are we stage-wise with the development. The blue indicates which ones have already been constructed. The two larger buildings, that are, this one's being occupied now, this is going to be ready for occupancy pretty soon. This is where the compactor unit was constructed, and these things represent the carriage house garages that we're talking about. So this is the, can you go to?
You want
go to
this
C,
one?
The C5 one. On the one you just had, I'm sorry.
That one or the other one?
The other one had the
comparison,
the red line versions of it. It's a little confusing, but I just wanted to make sure that everybody understood what was happening on this. This is the extension of Green Meadow Drive. Currently, this is the cul-de-sac. It has the kind of the decorative wall in it, if you've ever been to the end of Green Meadow Drive. And this is coming out. It was always intended to come out. And we had a single-family home that was located in this area, and that's being removed, and there's going to be a 3-car garage here. It's going to be, the 3-car garage here will provide some additional parking spaces, not only for these people, but also for the existing people that are on Green Meadow Drive here, just to give them some supplemental parking. And it'll free up these bump out spaces that we have for more for visitor parking than everyday use for those people. Also, it'll lessen the number of vehicles that have to be parked here because we're going to take one unit away from this. But by taking this unit away, it allowed us to kind of move these around a little bit, give a little bit more space between them. So that's why you see the slight rotation of the units on that side. The original plan had a sewer ejector station located here between these two units. The actual construction is going to be this parking garage first, and then this unit, and then this unit. So this side is going to be not constructed during the initial phase of the work. So we relocated the ejector station to come to this point. That'll let us put the electrical service and have the alarms and all of that stuff attached to the actual parking garage, the garage, instead of having it adjacent to one of the units. Just makes it cleaner and it makes it a little bit better. We also changed the style of this unit. This unit has a better appearance from the side, since it's going to have you're going to be coming down the road and see the side of the unit instead of the one that was there originally. So it's just a little bit more decorative as far as what it looks like when you're driving down the roadway. Other than that, the roadway is exactly the way it was. These units basically stayed the same. The one issue that the town engineer had, can you go to the utility plan on this one, please?
Which one is that one? 12 or 7?
7, I believe. Can
yep.
you blow it up? The issue that we had is when we originally planned for the extension of Green Meadow Drive, which was always intended to be done, we had put a gate in this location for the virtual extension. And then what happened was, because of the wetlands and some of the other things that happened on that side, we ended up kind of kicking the road more over in this way to make everything fit and to get everything away from the wetlands a little bit more. So the projection of this water line, you know, would have gone through the houses the way they were. So the design that we have is to connect to the existing gate that we have at the end of the roadway and bring it back into the roadway. So we're talking about maybe 25 feet of water line that's going to be in the front yard area of the condominium association. As you know, it's a condominium, so it's common land, so there's no real roadway layout or land ownership here. It's all common land with the condominium. George wanted us to not to do that, to kind of go back here and relocate the water line underneath the pavement section here. In case we ever had to dig this up, actually, if we ever had to dig it up, it's better to kind of dig it up in the lawn than it is to dig up the roadway. So I really had asked George to reconsider that, and I see in the memo that I got today that he still is asking for us to do that. Just so you understand, in order to have to do that, we have to go all the way. Can you back out? In order to shut that down, we have to turn all these houses down, and we have a gate here. So that means from this line to there, we'll all be out of service while we're doing that work. These people won't have any water. And then when we put the new line in, we'll have to rechlorinate from here, so there'll be a real a real inconvenience to the people who are living in these houses right now. And I don't know, for the sake of 20 feet of water line, it's in the road, I mean, in the driveway, in the lawn area there, I just don't see the benefit that we're going to get compared to the inconvenience that we're going to have to deal with here for the existing units that are here. So that would be my only request, is that we be allowed to do it as we have it on the design plans and bring the water main back into the roadway in that short section and then continue on and put the hydrant at the end the way we have it. So grade-wise, impervious area-wise, drainage-wise, everything remains a little bit less than what it was before because we removed the single-family home. We did replace it with the carriage garage, but the footprint of the carriage garage and the associated parking with it is less than what we're taking away from that. So there was no change with that portion of it. And we do have to, we will be removing all of this pavement that the existing island has right now. So that's that one issue. And could you go to the other, the C12, I believe, is the profile sheet. So the profile sheet just shows that it's exactly the same as it was originally. So if the layout remains the same. What we did is Talbot Lane is the other section here. This configuration is the way the units currently are on the end. There's a triplex unit that's on the end of the property here. Could you go to the sketch plan showing the unit relocation? We've taken this unit, and that unit has gone over to here, and we've taken one of the triplex units and put it there so that we end up with three duplexes here, similar to what we've done everywhere else. Almost all of everywhere else when we've done the modifications, we've made the modifications so that we've tried to eliminate the triplex units and replace them with duplex units. It gives more space. You end up with windows on more sides of the units, three sides instead of having a front and back with the interior unit, and it just frees up the space a little bit more. If you remember, we did an A&R plan with, we had to have Reading, Woburn, and Wilmington sign off on the A&R plan, which allowed us to buy a piece of property to the town line here, which allowed this unit swap to kind of happen. Because of the setback, the quirk in the zoning bylaw was that if you're along the town line, it's a 20-foot setback to the town line. If it's not a town boundary, it was a 50-foot setback to the town line. So we actually bought the property to the town line and filled in that circle. So that even though we're not, this is not the design plan, when we go actually get the building permit for this sometime when we go into the next phase, we'll give plans to George to show actually what the setbacks are. The intent of this plan was just to show that we're not losing a unit. We are going to replace it phase two to phase two. It's just going to be in a different location on that. And then in what Jesse was saying about in unit 30, which is the one that's going to be occupied probably, you know, within the end of the summer, we had in this building a community room that's for the people of the association. Again, instead of using this for all of the people that are in phase two, we're going to use a community room basically in this unit, and that one unit gets bumped into the unit that we have not constructed yet. And I believe that Brad and Ted can address where we are relative to the number of affordable units that are already constructed and occupied, and I believe we're well ahead of what our criteria is for meeting our goals as far as the build-out is concerned. So that in general is just what we're asking to have done with this minor modification. Relocate that, put the carriage garage there, and the minor adjustments that we made for the realignment of those units and the placement of the units. Brad, do you want to add anything?
Just one personal comment on what Phil was saying regarding the water line. I understand when there's a public way involved, you like to have it in the public way. It gives the town an unfettered right to get to the water line if it has to do any work. As Bill said, this is not a private front yard, so your condominium association that will in fact maintain the private waterway itself. And so therefore having it out of the way is better, not worse. So for the disruption that's a consequence of all that, I would question that we not have to do that. It seems, doesn't make a great deal of sense. As far as the affordable unit count, at Jesse's request, I provide a memo that we have as to phase two. We have to have 15% of the units be affordable. There'd be a total of 74 units to be online when 30 Taylor is completed. That will result in the requirement of 11 affordable units, 15% of the phase two. Actually, 12 units will be built, so we're ahead of the requirement as far as the bylaw is concerned. In phase one, 99 units have been completed. That's a 10% requirement, if you recall, of affordable units in phase one. We're also ahead of the count in that regard. So Ted has kept ahead all the way along. He's not squaring with the moment itself. So that's where we stand in that consequence. And Bill's laid out, I think, the reason for the changes and what they are. So we have nothing further. We're more than happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
What questions?
Is that an 8-inch water line?
Yes.
From his memo, I don't think he was concerned more about access as he was about if that line broke, whether it would erode the soil around that house and cause damage to the house. But if it's a condo association and the line breaks, I assume
condo association would fix it.
Yeah,
it's not going to have a heavy load bear on it that would have an erode. You're not going to have any kind
no,
of.
No, but when an 8-inch line goes, it's going to make a big hole. It's going to take away that whole corner of soil.
It's more than 10 feet off the house. The house foundation is actually below where the water main would be.
And then I don't have a problem with accessing it. I just what he was talking about. I don't have a problem with them accessing it across the lawn. The homeowner is protected to some extent because it's part of the condos. It's just an inconvenience if something's. It would have to be a pretty severe break.
Sure. And if you don't mind, if you just repeating, because we're very sensitive to affordable housing units, why we're wanting to move one from a building that's under construction to one that has not yet started?
I can answer that. Having visited a lot of apartments, if you go to Marketplace in Linfield, or you go to Inwood next door, or you go to Prima, a lot of these apartments have like a community room, place for people to gather, whether they're having a meeting, a birthday party, whatever, and we didn't have one here. And so I figured out a way to put one in this set in the middle building, so there's a little 1,000-foot meeting area right off the lobby. You can walk in from the lobby, you can walk in from outside. People can have a gathering of some sort there. And when, you know, basically I built a, you know, I don't want to call it free, I built a gathering room for people to use for the three. What I'm envisioning, the three 36, 37 unit buildings down in phase two, it's right between them. They can get there easily. The trash compacted room is right there. They're all used to being there. There's their space to communally do stuff. And we'll move that affordable unit over the next building. We were going to have 667, 676, 766. We're still going to have 667. It's just moving from this building to this building. So it made sense to me. And it'll be a facility that they can start using this fall. So that was the. It was just this is a better idea, you know, like this whole,
sure.
This thing's developed, let's do it. And I talked to DHCD, they're fine with it as long as you're fine with it, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Any other questions or concerns?
I just have a quick question.
Yeah, please.
I'm sure you talked with George about this, but this line weight is a little bit heavier. Are you making any grade changes along there, or is?
Well, where are you?
Right here in between building 67 and 68. So these are all bolded.
No, there's no changes whatsoever.
Okay.
That's just the way it is. When we did the proposed grading in the AutoCAD ends up being bold, and that was, we weren't really even doing anything on this part. It was just happened to be part of the CAD drawing for the other side.
Does that answer your question, Jesse?
Yeah, I mean, George didn't mention anything about it. I just think that sometimes the plans are a little difficult to understand.
He did have a question
what the changes
on,
are.
He did have a question on the middle building about why we were doing the sewer gas trap the way we were, and I explained it to him, and he said, oh, all right. He didn't understand the way it was configured. The sewer gas trap has to have a vent, two vents, and he was asking us why we had two vents. One of the vents has to go back to the building and go up to the roof, and the other vent on the other part of the downside has to be vented beyond, not to the roof. So it was just, so when I showed him the detail, he was fine with that.
So you had the lottery on this building, right?
So we had a lottery on both the first and second buildings. We went through all the lottery recipients. We've been first come, first serve for 9 months. And so I think we ended up with four lottery people in building one. We've now done first come, first serve for the last two units in building one, and one unit in building two, and we may have somebody for the second unit. I call it building two, the building that's gonna be done at the end of the summer. So I think we're gonna end up with affordable units waiting for someone to show up. It took us a year. Our last closing for building one will be maybe the end of June, and the units have been ready since September. So it took us a year to get all six of them occupied, you know, with qualified buyers.
Mm-hmm.
And we're at two of six in the second building. Hopefully, say we get another one in the next couple months, we'll be at three of six when the units are ready, and then we'll have three more waiting for somebody to show up that's qualified. Qualified by the DHCD standards, but we'll, you know, we're ahead of, you know, we don't have people waiting, we're ahead of the curve.
Right.
We're waiting for people. There, you know, people waiting for units.
Have we ever, I know we were talking about Jesse getting, I don't know if there was a resource available for a few towns to help source candidates for affordable housing units?
So we have the regional housing office, the Metro North Regional Housing Service office. We have a person that's staffed full time to manage four communities, Reading, North Reading, Wilmington, and Saugus. So at this point, that person has been working very diligently on collecting inventories of all the communities, on all the documentation for every single unit that we have on our SHIs. So that person, one of the goals of the office will be to sort of create a interested buyer list. At some point, we would like to have a ready buyer list, but that is a little bit more involved than sort of keeping track of folks that are just interested in when an affordable unit comes up for sale or comes up for a lottery. We could certainly have a list of folks that have expressed interest and send them notifications. So we are working on that. And that is one reason I did want an update from Ted, is because we do get calls occasionally from people looking for opportunities in Reading for affordable housing. So.
Thank you. You want to take a look at the decision? Can I just read finding two out loud to make sure that everything is, because there's a lot of information in that.
Sure.
You can let us know if we went astray here. So, finding number two, changes include one, relocation of the single family unit 73 addressed at 37 Green Meadow Drive to Talbot Lane. This unit will be combined with another unit on Talbot Lane to create a new duplex building, resulting in a total of 3 duplex buildings on Talbot Lane in Phase 2. 2, relocation of one affordable unit from 30 Taylor Drive to 16 Taylor Drive. This will allow for a community room, gathering place, work center near the lobby of 30 Taylor Drive. 3, as a result of the relocation of 37 Green Meadow Drive, a new 3-car garage will be installed in its place. Green Meadow Drive will also be revised to include 2 additional parking spaces. That's it.
We didn't talk about that, just to give you a little more. The one place we had a parking lot down there, which I think you're all too new to the board to remember this from 6 or 8 years ago, but, well, maybe not Dave.
Right.
But Green Meadow Drive, we started out with Green Meadow Drive, it was relatively dense, there were triplexes. And they were all single-car garages with single-car parking spaces for the most part in front, although some had to. We found that for people having kids coming home from college or a third car, that there were parking problems on the street there. There weren't enough extra spaces. So after we finished Green Meadow Drive, we basically figured out a way to revise our units so that every unit we've built since 2008 is a 2-car garage with 2 cars of parking, but 2 cars of parking in front of it. So we have 4 spaces per unit versus 2. The parking problem has disappeared everywhere except the original part of Green Meadow Drive. So the idea of this garage is a 3-car garage with 3 parking spaces behind it, 2 next door. We get 8 extra spaces for the called 16 units there. So it gives the one place we really need parking relief. Yeah, it's targeted to provide that down there. And, you know, you never have enough parking, but it increases the spaces per house by from 2 to 2.5. So it'll be a significant, I think, benefit to those people who need an extra space down there.
Okay, thank you. What else? Do we have anything else in the decision itself? Do we need to do anything with this highlighted section, finding number 5?
Nope, it's just to highlight just the vote.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, Bill raises a good point. The version we got doesn't have George's memo referenced, and you might, if you do want to add that, and then indicate if you so vote that. Appreciate that.
Sure. Okay. Does anybody have a concern with their proposal for relocating that?
No, I think we can do that.
Okay. So.
So we want to add a finding?
Yeah.
It should probably be a condition.
Wait, why is it a condition?
You
want to add it to the materials submitted, right?
Yep.
George's memo.
Yep.
And
I can
under
do
findings,
it.
You just want to list. You just want to say that the water line on Green Meadow Drive will remain as shown.
What sheet is that? Sheet C?
C7, I believe, is the utility sheet.
Yeah. And what's the date on that? I'll just add the date. I don't have to type it here.
It's in the materials submitted. If it's
5/17/15.
I
All right. You got George's memo referenced?
Yeah.
I do recall last time, well, I think I recall, last time you were here, George mentioned the fact that the plans were getting confusing.
We gave him.
And you gave him.
As-built of everything after that meeting.
You did, okay. Okay, perfect. Thank you.
As-built of the whole park.
Okay, thank you. I wasn't aware of that, but appreciate that. All right. Do we have a motion?
Move that the CPDC determine that the requested changes to the whatever it is, PUD decision and special permit constitute a minor amendment.
Second.
All those in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the minor amendment for the changes to Johnson's Woods as presented.
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks. Yep, no problem.
All right, moving right along. Are you here for the butcher shop? Which one? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Is anyone from the butcher shop coming?
They should be. Let me see if anybody's out.
See if they brought meat. Gene brings donuts.
New rule, you have to feed us.
Should we wait? I know I had some questions that are probably better answered by.
Yeah, we could certainly wait. We could certainly move on to Fuddruckers.
Yeah, we could jump to Fuddruckers if
you're ready.
It's not
a public hearing, so.
Are you waiting for more people?
Okay.
Okay.
Switch
and stick around. Now, once we get started, we'll finish you guys out. Do you feel you need to wait for James, or?
Well, he's also representing the
yes,
other.
Yes, that's next, but, well, we're doing Biltmore
and
Maine after
Fuddruckers.
Yes. Oh, wow.
Same architect is also representing
yes,
Biltmore and Maine.
Okay.
So, when he gets here, I'll just see if he's here yet.
Okay.
It's the 915 minor mod. So, that is the number.
Do we want to talk about the modular classrooms in the meantime?
We could do that. All right.
Oh, wait, I think I see Butcher Shop.
Hi.
Perfect timing.
How are you?
Outstanding.
Butcher Shop?
Yes.
Hi.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Nice to see you.
All right.
Any place okay?
Absolutely.
We got a few vacant chairs.
Are you waiting for anybody else?
No, just
no? Okay, then perfect. Let's jump right in. We weren't sure if anybody was going to be showing up. We're a little bit ahead
sure
of schedule, so.
I didn't know you were ahead of schedule.
Yeah, no, no problem.
It's very rare that we are,
yeah.
So.
Yeah, consider ourselves lucky. All right, so next up on the agenda, minor modification request to site plan review, 159, 169 Haven Street, Old Reading Butcher Shop.
So the proposal before you is for one 169
Sorry.
Haven Street.
Thank you.
Actually, I'm going to close that door too. The owner of the butcher shop is proposing an outdoor seating area that's just seasonally between May 1st and October 1st. He's proposing to use some of the existing parking spaces for this outdoor dining. There would be a total of 6 tables, 12 chairs. The applicant has submitted some photos showing the location of where these chairs would go, as well as some additional plantings that's proposed. We did receive some comments from staff expressing some concern about better delineation, maybe some better protective measures, and ultimately what they had recommended was possibly some larger planters. We have something here, sort of I don't know if I can actually open it, but it is in your packets, showing sort of larger planters. I will let the applicant go into a little bit more detail, and we can go from there.
Sure. Well, I guess the whole intention here is just to try to get some outdoor use or some use of the outdoor space that we have after a fairly miserable winter for all of the businesses, including ours. The intention was really just to create outdoor space, not just for anyone visiting the butcher shop. It's really more for people up and down Haven Street. Takes us a while to close the store at night, and when I leave at 6 o'clock, 7, 8 o'clock at night, there's a number of people up and down Haven Street, either with baby carriages or couples, and our intention was to have anybody use it. They wanted to park it and rest for a few minutes and take advantage of some seating, and that was pretty much it. We currently use 4 spaces, 3 or 4 spaces for our cars directly by our back door. And the spaces in between both buildings are not used between either ourselves or the tenants in the building. And we had some outdoor seating and thought we'd give it a try. We came up with the idea of maybe using some planters and also a retractable barrier in between both buildings to do what we could to ensure people's safety.
There's some photos of the proposed area.
The planters are about, I'd say 10 to 15 pounds each. They're certainly not going to stop the vehicle. But in the 6 years that we've been there, almost 6 years that we've been there, we've never, ever, at any point in time had an issue with any cars being damaged, anybody being hurt. It's always been a spot that has been low traffic, just people in and out of their cars towards the back of the parking lot, which unfortunately you can't see. The entire, where I was referring to the 4 spaces where we park when we're open, that would be to the immediate right of those planters.
Is that on this one photo?
Yeah.
I don't know if you can see from there, but yeah, it's showing the other direction. You gave us a photo, I think that's...
Right, and in that photo, I think you can actually see 2 of the employee cars parked there.
So this area here on the aerial, right? So this is Haven.
Where they park.
This is Haven Street.
Yeah, and as he said, the 4
right,
spaces
exactly
in between the buildings, you can't get to them, and nobody uses them.
Do people ever use those spaces?
We never do. The 4 spaces that we use are right there.
Do customers ever?
We,
I wouldn't know how to. I've seen them. I wouldn't know how to get to them.
you know what? Truth be told, we've told customers that have come in the store and mentioned that. I went around 2 or 3 times. I couldn't find a parking space. We've mentioned this numerous times, just
right before you get to the blue mailboxes, make a left and come on in and use the spaces. And on occasion, rarely, on a Saturday and a Sunday, where they will park is these spots right here. There's about 10 or 12 spots. Literally, as soon as they pull into the parking space or into the driveway, they notice that there are spots available.
You own the entire property, both 169.
My partner Larry Hodson owns 157 and 169, and we are partners in the business.
Well, it's in the application. It's described as outdoor dining, but I do not believe you have a dining license.
We do not, and describing it as outdoor dining, I can't say is 100% accurate, because all we do is sell sandwiches that people take out, and
they might decide to sit there and eat it. I understand.
Yeah, and that's the whole level of it.
It's a good idea. I'm not sure if there's pedestrian access. I mean, in the photo, there's some foliage between them, and there's obviously a barrier of some kind. Yeah.
There's a break in the hedges. I don't know. It's right where you just scanned in. Right there, there's a break in the hedges. It's about 2.5-3 feet wide that people can access.
A couple of pavers there, right?
I'm sorry?
A couple of pavers.
Yeah, there's two large pavers that take up the area where the shrubs are not.
I mean, because arguably somebody might come along with the ADA compliance question. It's taking advantage of the space that's there and otherwise unused. And of course, administratively, more complicated than you would want it to be.
ADA access, the only
4 foot,
right?
Wheelchair kind of accessible.
Right, and that was the entire reason why we actually put in a 5x5 bathroom right in the store. And we've got the handicap button on the outside of the store. That's
right.
You know, we wanted to make sure that we were 100% ADA compliant.
Mm-hmm.
So do you envision that your customers will come out the front door and then walk around, or do you have a door back here?
We do, but it's really employee only. There is a concrete platform where we get our deliveries. I have compressors on back there as well. There's really no access for customers to go from the inside of the store through the back door.
There is no side door access.
No, just a mural.
Right.
And there's a few doors that show on the mural.
Maybe that's what I was thinking about.
Yeah.
So realistic. Now, I'm sorry.
No, please.
Did you talk with the tenants in this building about those spaces? Are they concerned that, I mean, it sounds like they're not used that often, but we constantly hear that there's not enough parking in the downtown. Constantly hear that. And so we certainly wouldn't want to do something where these tenants are going to be impacted by the loss of these four spaces, which it looks like they're very hard to get to, but...
And I don't think that once you know the spaces are there and they're available, if you've been there once, then you know that they're available to you. For instance, Bill Crowley and Bill Keating park their vehicles just to the right-hand side of the building. They have the first few spots that they take. As soon as you go into the driveway, and then you generally have 9 or 10 spaces along the back of the property, right in back of 159, that are almost always vacant. And occasionally you'll see a car or two in there that'll occupy it. They're there for 10 or 15 minutes. There are some people that know enough that if they need to go to the bank or the post office, they'll bring the car in, but nobody's ever there for any length of time. As far as the area in between both buildings, and not just in this photo, but I mean, I've been there 5.5 years, and I'd be hard-pressed to tell you, even remember how many times I saw vehicles in there. Now, the reason I wanted it to be considered as seasonal is, in view, and this past winter was a great example for this. That's where we put all of our snow to clear out the rest of the parking lot. And that's an important space during October to April to keep vacant, whether for cars or snow or, you know, whatever else it's going to be needed for. My intention anyways was to look at it as strictly seasonal, something that running from May to October would just encourage people to, you know, sit down and concentrate on Haven Street being a popular place.
In the best of all possible worlds, which discounts the cost of such things, it would be wonderful to have a portion of the area with the, you know, repaved, if you will, maybe porous pavers of some kind, and basically for use as the outdoor patio area, so that it would be clearly not a parking place, but at the same time it would be certainly usable in the bad weather for things like the snow storage and so forth. And with, you know, some opportunity for vehicular barrier or distinction. You know, I'm not sure that we need a barrier as much as even just a little bit raised. Would discourage the, I think it's a great idea. I'm not sure where the zoning and so forth affects it. You're in the downtown area, you're not subject to the typical parking requirements. You have enough parking for the staff. And you certainly have control of the space. So
I think from a staff perspective, it's primarily, you know, safety related in terms of providing maybe some larger planters. I can't pull up the picture, but I can show you a picture that was suggested in terms of planter size. You know, just something a little more substantial, not necessarily strictly for safety, but again, to Dave's point, trying to create sort of that atmosphere that you're not just sitting in a parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
But let me see if I can pull that up and see if that's...
Well, we haven't. I mean, in the...
What if you were just to block out the yellow lines to take away the appearance of parking lot, but just to leave it the asphalt surface for a cost-effective solution?
Well, that certainly would be a very, very simple thing to do. We could certainly take that project on in a heartbeat. My biggest concern, more than anything else, of course, is people's safety. Whether it's planters or a Jersey barrier or anything substantial. I think the whole point of just having planters there was also to enhance eye appeal.
Sure.
At some point in time, just like what you see here, you know, umbrellas would be wonderful, just so people have an idea that there is seating there and it's available. Painting the yellow stripes, certainly not an issue. Even during the winter, those are spots that
pays attention to the yellow spots.
They really don't.
Yeah.
And as I said, just this past winter, it really served a benefit because we had, at any given time, six and a half feet of snow that we would not have been able to put anywhere else.
I think it's a great idea, sort of like those pop-up parks that people are, you know, in New York and other places that people are repurposing parking spaces, on-street parking spaces to parks, reusing what is dominated for vehicles and turning it into usable space. So
I think
it's great, and to keep it as cheap and flexible as possible.
The only, I guess, and not to interrupt
you,
I'm
sorry,
John. The larger planters, I'd have to consider as more of a permanent placement.
And then what do you do with them in the winter?
Well, you wouldn't have to, because what you can do is you can, like, you know the water-filled Jersey barriers?
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
You could fill the bottom half of it with container. Fill with water and drain, so that gives you the ballast that you need to stop the car, and you put the plants on top of that, so you'd really only have regular pot depth, probably what you're showing there. You could put maybe four of them in there, or if you look at this parklet where they're using more of a rectangular, more of a linear piece, you could maybe have three or four 6 foot long troughs that you fill with plants and ballast. Maybe you put cement blocks at the bottom of it and then put the plants on top of that. So from the outside, it looks like a wood planter, but you know, the plants are easily moved, and then each of the individual ballast pieces is easily moved.
Yeah. Or by the same token, the interlocking rubber tiles, you know, in the grid work or something makes it clearly, you know, not a parking place, but it's something you can pick up and stick in a box over in the bad weather.
Yeah, and essentially, I mean, while we initially had some of the tables and chairs on display, I have a basement in the 159 building, which, you know, in all of 15 or 20 minutes, the tables and chairs are brought downstairs. I was trying to attempt to do this at the lowest cost possible.
Sure.
Of course.
And being a former Atlantic person, trying to carry the reputation forward, we really enjoy a wonderful word-of-mouth business, and we're a business that doesn't even advertise. With that being said, we have promotions sometimes for Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, the football team, all of which sometimes has to occur either out on the sidewalk or inside the store.
Mm-hmm.
At this time of year, although we don't see a lot of it, it'd be great in September to have them be able to use that space as well. And that's how we do our advertising. It's really through all the nonprofits.
What I would say is, you know, there's definitely been, staff has a concern about kind of blocking off that.
Demarcation
is a good word. But I think there's certainly options to kind of solution it. And maybe we have a condition that says you kind of go back, do some estimates, find a solution that works, and work with the planning staff to kind of review it and approve it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Would everyone on the board be agreeable to that?
Yeah, don't do these retractable extensions.
Yeah, those were...
Yeah.
I think Global actually has some great, really cost-effective larger planters.
Global?
Yeah, or some of these websites definitely have them.
Okay.
The former gigantic, heavy, expensive planters have now been replaced with these really lightweight, good-looking pieces of material that you could never tell from a distance.
Okay.
You don't have to fill the entire thing with the plants. You just sort of fill it up with something, and then you put your plants on top of that because it's all safe. It would look like those. You can see how deep they were. And the other piece, I'd be more concerned about is it is a great idea, but this looks kind of like somebody's bad yard sale. And if the furniture is really light, people are just going to move it around. They're going to take it, or it's going to get blown away.
Yeah.
So you have to be careful with that. That's why outdoor furniture is so heavy, so that it doesn't just take it down the street with them.
Do you intend to pull the tables and chairs in every evening?
Well, that's what I was doing, just for security reasons.
And then the planters?
Well, the planters, since they would be more of a permanent, permanent thing, I'd want to leave them.
Yeah.
Leave them out until
the end of the season.
Until first week in October.
Right. Yeah, I think that would be a much more preferred method of demarcation, to leave something out during the season.
Yeah.
A little bit more substantial to my explanation.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I think that makes perfect sense. Tables and chairs are one issue, but I think using anything as a barrier needs to be considered seasonal.
Sure.
As opposed to daily.
What about garbage and maintenance? Would you provide a garbage can? Would you have somebody in your staff go out and make sure there wasn't something spilled or anything like that?
I have somebody that monitors that every 15, 20 minutes.
Okay.
My front end staff does that all the time.
Good. Okay. Perfect.
And that just goes in line with
that responsibility.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, there's really not any sort of. Oh, actually, there is a trash can right there. It looks like it's full.
It's already overflowing.
So you want to, keep an eye on that. We certainly want to make sure that there's not any debris.
We did have a receptacle just past, just underneath some of the shrubs where the Boy Scouts are.
Mm-hmm.
Got a few extras, and that's pretty much where we set it up, just for people walking in and out, plain enough to see the garbage can. But I we take great pride in this store. I mean, it's just not sweeping. We do our own power washing.
It's spotless. It's great.
Well, I don't know how else to do it.
Well said.
An adventure like this is we take it on seriously, and I believe in the town, and I want smiling faces. I mean, Haven Street, when I first moved there, we were pretty much the only retailer that was open on that street 5.5-6 years ago. That's,
yep.
Okay, well.
The blacking out of the lines,
just look like black lines.
Kind of replace the yellow with the black.
But in terms of, that's to a certain extent cosmetic. I mean, the modification of the site plan basically is reduce the 18 spaces to 14. Basically, say that these are not parking places anymore.
During the
season,
even they're not parking places. They might be snow storage in the winter, but there's no particular need for the 18 parking places, since they're obviously not used.
I'd hate to pull that out.
No, we're not doing that. Because in the middle of the season, if he needed to for some reason, he could move the planters out of the way, take away the chair, and park his cars there. So restrict how you use the lot, it's too flexible. Plus, the tenant next door may change, or this tenant may change.
Okay, and if I move the parking spaces 18 feet towards the, away from the sidewalk, it's still four parking places.
No, it's not, because it tightens up. You can get two spaces. If you put these planters at the, where the green paint stops on the fish market mural, you can get two spaces in here. If you go to the plot plan that they submitted, you'll see that.
For some reason, I don't have it on the computer. Okay.
Well, maybe it's available. If you get back to the area, I'll take it away.
As you
can
see,
the buildings are kind of...
Yeah, it's much wider.
Yeah.
It's a tapered entrance.
Right, and then the next door building has all of its AC units on the ground up there as well.
Mm.
So you might be able to get two spots there if you put the planters about 15 feet from the end of the parking space area about there. At best. I say we don't change anything about the parking. This is just seasonally the way we described it.
Yep.
It's flexible. You can move it anytime you want.
Okay.
What's behind you?
Yep.
So I think the condition, now looking at the decision, sorry if I'm jumping ahead, but the condition around protective measures would be one that would be agreed to between yourself and staff once you have an opportunity to go back, do some research, and come up with a solution that addresses some of the feedback you've heard.
Sure.
Okay, good.
Yeah, I'll certainly look at the enlarged planters. I'll research it and see what's out there, and then we'll continue our discussions.
Yeah, you can certainly work with me in my office, and we can sort of figure out a good solution.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
The landscaper for the property might be a really good resource.
Excuse me, dear.
The landscaper for the property might also be a really good resource to sort of give you a cost-effective idea of where to purchase the planters.
Yeah, you're talking to the landscaper.
Oh, really?
But thank you for
the teams of landscapers.
Thank you for the suggestion.
As a finding number two, it includes the retractable planters. I would just change it to a series of heavy planters and then the leaf feed.
What else?
Probably just if you pull it back, you probably in there sizable enough, you probably just need four of them.
You saw this.
Well, I don't think we need to be.
No. I'm not saying that. I was just trying to think that through. Is that. Sort of the bigger they get, you sort of the less you'd need if they're in good shape.
Yeah, you could use maybe four or five really big ones, and then you could fill them with the smaller ones you have in between or around it.
Well, there's more than enough spots for the smaller ones, and if the larger ones have a large enough girth, what I would probably intend to do is just not line them up right next to one another, give us a
right.
2-foot access in between,
yeah,
something
yeah.
along those lines.
Yeah.
Do we need a condition about the access from Haven Street?
What would it say? What are you thinking?
Accessible. I mean, right now you've basically got to squeeze between the plants that are there.
Well, there is a little pathway. It's two pavers. It's not really too formal, but
why is there another plant right up against the building?
I don't know.
No, there's two pavers, probably about.
It's not in this picture,
area,
but it's right over there.
Two and a half feet wide.
That looks like it's more than 2.5 feet.
Oh, there it is.
Mm-hmm.
From the corner of the building to that first spot? Or is there something behind all those voicemails?
There are, there's an extension of the hedges
okay.
behind the voicemails.
Yeah, well, tell them to provide a 3-foot wide access.
Minimum 3 foot, yeah.
So that would mean probably taking up one of those hedges and putting down, you know, a couple of papers, yeah.
Just plant the hedge in one of the planters.
What?
If you plant Christmas trees in the pots, you can sell them off at the same.
All right.
Okay.
I don't think we need anything about garbage and maintenance, do you, anything? No, it's sort of standard operating procedure. We're not gonna black out the lines, keep that. All right, we good?
Okay.
Yeah.
Move that the CPDC approve the minor modification for the use of the parking area between 159 and 169 Haven Street.
Second.
All those in favor? All right.
Thanks very much.
This is great. Thank you for doing this.
It's tough.
Good to see you all. Thank you. Jesse, thanks.
Thanks.
We'll be in touch.
Yes, sounds good.
Thank you.
All right. We good? Keep going?
I'm going to take a short break.
All right. 5 minute break. And then we'll pick up with Fuddruckers.
Yes, please. Great.
Okay.
How many minutes?
5?
Oh, sure.
So we'll get started at 8:56. That clock's not right. minor site plan review application and certificate of appropriateness for 50 Walker's Brook Drive Fuddruckers. Jesse, you wanna kick us off?
Sure. So the owner of the Fuddruckers restaurant here in Reading is here with us tonight along with his team. They are proposing some interior renovations to expand the number of seats that they have. They have a deficit in what they actually need. They're doing so well that they need more seats. They're also going to be just doing some cosmetic upgrades to the interior. And they're also going to be upgrading their signage that's on the outside. Currently, it's awning signage, and they're proposing to change that to have galvanized metal awnings over the windows and then an actual wall sign. So we're taking the signage off of the awning with this new proposal. I will let the applicant go into more detail and go from there.
I'm Nicole Carroll, designer. This is Jim Boland, owner, and James is our architect. Dave is a potential contractor. So that's our team at the moment. And the current Fuddruckers has a big bait. I'm assuming everybody's been there at some point, yes? So you go into Jordan, so you see it. They have a giant bakery up front right now that we're going to take out, which gives us the ability to add more seats. And we're also proposing where you see on the...
we have a pointer if you would like one.
Yeah. So this is the demo plan where you see the... So this is the existing bakery. This is... we're proposing cutting a little seating area into the space. Here, this is all pretty vacant space, not used as well as it could be. We're trying, you know, the light show is down here, the climbing thing is down there, so we're trying to make this a little more entertaining and interesting for patrons. Right now, he has, you know, there's not a lot of construction really. There's a couple little low walls that exist, and these are sort of, you know, kind of like a fakey little trellis thing with a communal table in it. So it's coming down, but it's not structural. It's not, you know, it's really kind of furniture. So we're taking that out, changing the seating plan, doing all new finishes, moving some of this bakery equipment into the kitchen. He does shakes, that's coming back here. So we're making a whole new front counter area here. That's gonna just increase efficiency. He's changing some equipment that's going to really increase the quality of the food. Let him reduce the staffing and get us to have, you know, more people in the space. This is the produce bar, which is very important to Fuddruckers, and we're going to move it up to this area here so that you see it when you come in. And, you know, just we're going to widen this a little bit, increase the flow, make this much more appealing and much more efficient. So that's our goals. This is the new seating plan. So this is where this is, I would say all of this is pretty much existing. The kitchen is primarily existing with a few pieces of equipment changing. This is going to be a new expo system. So this is new here. We've got a new island here for the shakes. They do beer and wine. And this is our new front counter, which is just bumping out. The furniture plan, this is a essentially similar to what we have, but we're proposing this fireplace to divide the space a little bit more. This is our produce area, which is just moving from here to here. And then this is where we used to have the bakery, so we have the opportunity for more seating.
I'll pull up the signage real quick. So
this is the existing, this is what we're proposing, and some of this is coming from Fuddruckers corporate standards. So what they have is actually a yellow awning, which we don't like as much as a galvanized awning. So we're proposing the galvanized. This new logo is a black and white version. You know, in the past it's been red, white, blue, yellow, a lot of colors in neon, and we're trying to make a much more revised statement and a little bit more subdued. There's already some lighting, which I think we have a night ver- do you have the night view that I sent you? I mean, it, as you know, it's in the Jordan's complex, so you have a very, you know, you have a lot of wild, crazy color, purple, green, yellow, and Jordan's over here, and we're just trying to make this much more modern, fresh, and clean over here.
That's a render. I mean, that's a Photoshop.
Yes.
Not a lighting analysis.
No. So, in speaking with staff, some of the concerns that we had, we wanted to ensure that there was compliance with the parking regulations. So we did ask for a parking compliance summary from the architect, which got an existing.
Right. I got your email on Friday. I was out on Friday, but I looked into it today. Currently, there is a surplus of parking for the required restaurant use, and with the Jordan shop as well. Basically, what we're talking about is increasing the seats from 150 to 250 feet seats. So currently, there's a requirement for 38 parking spaces for that, which would increase to 63. Increasing the staff spaces from 15 to 20 spaces. The existing parking spaces is 798 spaces, and our total requirement would be 786. So we would still be exceeding the parking by about 12 spaces. And I can formally revise that letter.
Jackson,
as well.
And the 798
has been
confirmed
in
the
deal? Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, we want that. Absolutely, no problem.
What else, Jesse? Any other?
I had some initial discussions about the proposed signage. So if you notice here, obviously they're showing some window coverings. I talked to them about that.
I took those out.
Yeah.
We're not going to do those anymore.
So, and then they had a light fixture proposed, which, you know, I wasn't too sure what the CPDC would think about it if I can pull those out.
Yeah, so I would show them this. The new one that I
yep.
sent you, because I think we like it better anyways, so that's fine.
Yeah, so this is what they originally had proposed, and you know, I was working with Nicole, and she certainly came back with a revised solution. You know, this, you know, you could certainly, I know in the past the CPDC doesn't like to see the actual light source. This fixture seems to sort of create that opportunity to see the light source. So on page 71 of your desk packets, is a copy of Nicole's email showing a revised fixture. It's a galvanized metal.
It's still a gooseneck. So it's similar. Just as the shade is angled so that you don't see the actual bulb, which is what Jesse suggested, and I'm better with that anyways. This is from Fuddruckers Corporate as a suggested fixture, so I like the second one better anyways.
Has Fuddruckers Corporate approved this yet? Are they?
No.
No way yet?
It's in there. They have it now, and they're looking at it now. So
okay.
I told them we need to come to you for approval. They need to approve it, and Jordan's also needs to approve it, and they also have it as well.
Okay.
They've had it for a while. We presented to Elliot and the Jordan's folks, and they loved it.
Okay.
And they know I'm here tonight, so they're very supportive of it.
Okay.
And I don't anticipate a problem with Fuddruckers, but I'm
right.
not sure. I sit on the franchise board for Fuddruckers, so I know all the players very well. But they may.
Sure.
You know, but I just don't know. That's why we put in there just if there is a minor revision of some type that still falls within the parameters of what you approve, so we wouldn't have to come back again.
Right,
that would
right.
be favorable.
As long as you're aware, depending on what they come back with
yeah.
the feedback, you may have to come back. But we would prefer you not having to do that.
Me too.
So.
Okay, fair enough. And they know I'm here also tonight.
Okay. Good, thank you. Everything, you good?
good, Jesse?
Yeah, so as it relates to the interior, they'll need to make sure that they get all their Board of Health approvals. They are proposing a fireplace that's going to require an additional permit from the fire department. So they'll certainly coordinate, you know, those details with the building permit application when they seek that.
Okay, great. What questions do we have?
So the one big change, I mean, if like you said, there's a lot going on in the back of that building, you know, or if that's the front, I don't that's all well and fine. It sort of tones it down from the yellow, and I guess, you know, if that works, that works. So the only thing here that I really see is in terms of a difference in terms of site plan stuff is the lighting, and the lighting being higher on the building above the
these two pieces?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I don't know if that's an issue. I'm just bringing it up in terms of that's really, from my perspective, that's the only thing that's really a change in terms of site plan as opposed to the parking, which we're going to get the letter, and you know, the design stuff. And I always know that lighting on, especially on this, I think on this back side, has historically been an issue, right? That is before my time.
Well, because of the butters,
yeah. Yeah.
I don't, you know.
I think this is far enough back that.
Yeah.
That
picture.
Yeah, don't.
Yeah. I don't think it would be a problem. But then, as you say, it's like dealing with corporate. Sometimes you don't know.
The wall sign is internally illuminated and halo illuminated.
Yeah, right. I mean, the way we discussed what understanding your bylaws is that we're not allowed to have the whole thing backlit, right? So just the Fuddruckers are backlit letters, that's what you allow, and the rest is a painted sign, so that's why we need the gooseneck to light it. And halo lit, so it's got a not, you know, very subtle light around the edges.
Yeah. I'm looking at Nick. Yeah.
The goosenecks are going to take away the whole bottom of the halo effect.
Well, we,
so you're going to
pay
for a halo effect, and the gooseneck's going to wipe it up.
So.
And look how crowded that is. I mean, get rid of those two goosenecks. Pick the sign up a little bit away from those awnings.
Okay, move it up a little bit, take those out.
Yeah, it's just so crowded.
Yeah.
I mean, that's.
Maybe a little smaller would even look better.
Fine with us. Yeah.
That's okay.
Yeah, we're okay with that. I really only added those because I thought Jesse and I discussed needing them, so I added them for kind of maybe misunderstanding. but yeah, I think that's fine. We can down, you know, scale it down a little bit, move it up, get rid of those two.
This is a custom sign, right? You're gonna have to have
yep.
to make them.
Yeah.
So
yep.
What if the Fuddruckers banner had the backlight? I mean, the Fuddruckers is internally
yes.
illuminated, but the banner that it sits on could have your halo lighting. It would light your disc.
True.
Yeah.
You can see world.
Yeah.
You
so
can
if
see
it was layered, so you had the halo lighting going right there, and
there,
up
yeah,
lighting
exactly.
onto the
so behind
onto
the
bottle cap.
It would light your disc.
That's
if you get rid of those goosenecks, and you wouldn't need the halo behind.
I would prefer that. That would be great.
And you're not illuminating under the canopies, right?
No.
That's what this
yeah.
That's why these fake
right.
rims.
Those are there. Those are Jordans, and they uplight out of the plants all around the building.
Yeah,
yeah
I know.
Yeah.
But the
yeah.
photoshopping makes it look like everything's glowing. See the glow around the bottom
mm-hmm.
of the canopies.
Yes.
You won't get that effect.
No.
Okay, the other thing.
I like that. I'm sorry. I like that sign. I think that fixes
that's fine.
The
you
issues.
You can
yeah.
fix that,
yeah.
yeah. No problem.
The other issue that comes to mind is that there's a big difference between 150 and 250. With no change in the egress or ingress. I presume somebody is working about the public safety issue of moving an extra 100 people out of there in case of an emergency.
Yep. We've already
that. Yeah, I believe that the egress is working. And as we go through the building process anyway, we'll have to vet that with the building inspectors and the construction drivers. But I believe that the egresses that are in place can handle the work.
I mean, it's because when you look at the plan, there's the egress. egress out of the restaurant, but there's also the main egress for the whole building is right at their front entry, and that would handle the entire, the movie theater, Jordan's, everything, the restaurant. So that is accommodating.
Well, it's required to handle it.
Right.
The question
so
of
that's,
it can.
Yeah.
We did it, yeah.
But it's scaled for that number of people already.
It's an extra 75 people out the main entrance and 75 people out that door.
Yeah.
And every door, every 36-inch door is accounted for 44.
Okay.
We did have a DRT and the egress issue was discussed. The architect is going to have to make sure that he meets all the egress requirements.
I am not an expert. I just noticed.
It is going to be it's a lot more seats, but I guess it's a good problem to have.
Yes.
The majority are being built in the area that's currently the bakery. It just doesn't seem like that big of an area.
Well, and the whole restaurant.
Yeah,
the whole restaurant can afford more seating.
It's sparse at the moment.
It's a big restaurant.
Yeah, there's
seats.
Yeah. Lots of spaces.
Seating,
space
yeah.
in between.
Yeah, I mean, some number of years ago when they had the little racing things or whatever was out front.
Oh, yeah.
Stop the restaurant and it has absorbed a lot more of the space that wasn't adjacent to it.
And are you going to be moving at all into that no man's land that's in front of it right now?
A little bit. Right, if you look at that, can you pull up that one floor plan?
The furniture plan?
Yeah.
Right there. Yeah, that one. So just this area here, we're proposing to extend it into that space.
Anything we can do, that's probably not your space or not necessarily your problem, I don't know. But
well, I mean, so we talked to Jordan, I mean, we've talked to Jordan's, you know, we had our own internal meeting about, you know, other stuff. That they might want to do. So they're happy about turning this into usable space. You know, we talked about what if we did something over here? What if we did something over here? You know, so we've talked about all these areas and they're open to, you know, maximizing it because it's really not utilized the best way it could
right.
be right now.
Dangerous. I see kids using it as a racetrack for.
It's just open space. I think we're doing something positive with it by filling it with a little bit of restaurant space.
Okay, well that's good. I'm glad we're going to start using some of that here.
So, that reminds me that when it first opened up, there was a whole issue with the Board of Selectmen and the beer and wine license and having that front area. Were you around to that?
I was.
So, I know there was an issue and there was a lot of discussion about it. I don't remember what it is. And I would hope that whatever you're doing complies with whatever sort of regulations that they put in place then.
It
I'm
will.
Sure that if it doesn't, you're going to hear about it. So
yeah.
He'll be
out,
yeah. He'll have to go back to the selectman to amend his liquor license.
Okay.
And we did talk about that very issue and ways to sort of.
Yeah, I changed one thing already.
Yeah, mitigate that access to alcohol
okay.
issue. Right. Yeah. But ultimately, it will be up. Them in regards to that.
Yeah.
So.
But it's good that you were part of that discussion so you know it all. So, yeah,
I do remember. In this room.
I do remember the pinball machine discussion, whatever it is.
I do. I remember that also.
The only other observation I have is the condiment bar seems far away from where you get your food.
Yeah,
I don't know if that's
yes,
is that
that's our discussion. That is definitely intentional because right now it's here, and this is the cook machines, this is the column, and this is expo. So right now this is jammed with people crisscrossing each other trying to get to the, you know, this is 10 people deep on a Saturday getting their drinks.
Yep.
We're adding a third Coke machine to increase the capacity, but now this is just going to be people. You know, you come, you do your order. This is getting pushed out. This is here now. So this is much wider than it currently is. Right now it's like a 4-foot hallway. So you have all these people smushed against the wall, which we're going to open up. This is very tight right now. We're opening that up. So it's going to be a little bit more like, you know, you go to whatever register is open as opposed to you wait in this long line that goes way out here. And then you get up, you know, you go one by one. So we're changing that flow. This is Coke machine land, so that's going to be much better for everybody. And this is separated people from talking to the kitchen line, trying to, you know, fix that problem that they have right now. And then now this is, you know, this is going to be crowded with people getting their condiments and their toppings. So that's fine, though. We like it there because get them away from here.
It's also two-sided, so it'll, you know, we can double the output of people, because if you've been there like on a Saturday or Sunday when it's busy, it's just, you know, up by the soda, the freestyle machines are complicated.
Right.
You know, people love them, but they're a hassle in some regards. So as Nicole said, you know, the line backs up 10, 12 people and they can't get their ketchup. And for us operationally, it's actually easier to have it up front, but it's better for the guests to have it here. I think it's going to disperse the flow and disperse the people. And just because we get complaints, people waiting in line for the soda machines all the time to try and get ketchup.
And now it's also, you know, where it is, it's too easy to, you know, get your condiments and hang out here to wait for your food or something, you know, wait for other stuff. So you get a whole crowd of people waiting with the Coke machine people just kind of hanging out. So this will force them to maybe go sit and then do this and then get your food.
We have both a draft certificate of appropriateness and minor site plan review.
Some excellent ideas. Want to make sure we get that.
So you want to start with the signage?
Yeah, that was first in my packet, right?
Yep.
Is that all right? Do you have a stamp? Do you have a stamp over there? No.
Oh. Thanks, Nick.
So we can take four off, because I don't think we do have any windows anymore, or I guess, I mean, it doesn't really say specifically, but if you wanted to leave it on there, it leaves the door open, I suppose.
Yeah, because we may want to put, like, fresh baked buns or, like, a strip.
So let's just leave it on.
Yeah.
But if we did it, it would comply to your 30% rule.
I assume we'll mark this up. Alright. Oh, we're talking about that.
The we probably want to revise drawing of Nick's suggestion from them. Yeah. Exactly. Yep.
Yeah.
Then, do we want to mark this up as well as far as what we discussed? All the cruise lines?
No, just the ones over
the
main just the two
sign.
Over the
we still
sign.
Want them over the awnings.
Never mind.
B.
then we said we would move the sign up.
Yes.
How wide are the windows?
I believe they're close to 36 wide. I think that sign in general is scaled to maybe like 36 by 6.
64 inches high.
So do you need a revised drawing from Bluebird to be resubmitted?
Yeah,
so what'll happen is they've stamped these drawings, that'll go into their approval. What happens next is you actually get a building permit from the building inspector, as well as your electrical contractor will need to pull a permit for the lighting work.
Yep.
And at that point, as part of that application, I will need the revised drawings because the permit will reflect what was discussed here.
Okay.
Hold on, I was gonna stamp those. So
great.
Take those. Are you okay with these then?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Just making sure.
So I've added conditions 3 and 4. So 3 is the applicant shall provide a revised wall sign drawing to depict illumination of the two gooseneck lights and to modify the halo illumination so that it shines from behind the Fuddruckers banner portion of the sign. The entire wall sign shall be shifted to be more evenly positioned between the upper floor windows and the awnings.
Great.
Anything else that we want to add for the signage?
I think that covers it.
Okay.
What's the size of the sign?
What
did you say it was?
Your drawing says it's 64 inches. It's unclear what exactly it's pointing to, but it's showing the height.
So whatever drawing you submit, we'll want to make sure that those dimensions are clearly shown.
Yeah.
And then on the permit form
we
application,
usually do,
you'll
so
fill that out.
Clearly labeled, but we'll add this.
Okay.
It's just line up with it.
Yeah, okay.
So, but I'm assuming they mean their overall height is 64.
Yeah, that makes some sense.
So if that's 5 feet, then that's
yeah, but somewhere around like 5 by 8,
right.
So. Okay, yeah, we'll add those dimensions.
Okay.
Move that the CBDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for the proposed sign at Fuddruckers, the wall sign at 50 Walker Street Drive.
Second.
Wait, I've got a question. I'm sorry. What do we say about the windows? Are we putting?
So we want to leave that on there, but we are not doing the full window, obviously, because that's not allowed. So. If we did
that's
anything, it would apply. You're only
okay.
Allowed 30% of the window coverage. So
all
we
right.
Know that now. And if we do anything, it will comply.
Okay. Do I need to, should I add that here, you think? Or is it covered in that?
Yeah,
condition?
I think it's covered in the condition.
Okay, good. All right, so we have a second. All those in favor? All right.
Okay. Draft decision on the modification, or do we just end this here?
Thank you.
So, delete number three under finding?
Yep. The window fill and architectural curves go away.
Do we need a condition about the parking?
Mm-hmm.
Just formalizing that?
Mm-hmm. So we did include here that condition related to any changes about Butterucker's corporate. When I spoke with Jim about this, you know, changes that they could come up with sort of related to like materials and
right.
You know, what the seats are going to be made out of. And so I think a lot of those changes certainly be approved administratively. Anything related to the signage or exterior, you know, we would want to take a look at, and we may have to bring it back to the board.
That's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Is the board comfortable with that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Move that the CPDC approve the minor site plan review decision for the proposed renovation of Footruckers at 50 Walker's Brook Drive.
All those in favor?
All right. Great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Can we take a couple minute break? I'll be right back.
Sure. No, you're right. So Nicole asked for a quick break because I believe she's involved in Biltmore and Main.
She'll be right back in.
Oh, okay. Do we want to start anything else or should we?
To give some town planner updates, not necessarily the classrooms, but.
Sure.
So we have coming up the hazard mitigation plan update forum next week on the 17th. So the CPDC is welcome to attend that. That will be at the community room at the police station, 7 p.m. So we'll be talking about the update to the 2010 plan, giving an overview of the process, and hopefully get some initial thoughts and comments from the public on that. We'll be developing the update over the summer with staff. It will be presented to the CPTC at some point, as well as the Board of Selectmen. I think we have that scheduled for September to bring before this board. We had the second forum for the Economic Development Action Plan on, it was last week,
Wednesday,
right?
Yeah.
So Dave attended. I don't know if you want to say anything about it, your thoughts on how it went and...
It was very busy. I mean, I was basically playing citizen rather than anything else. There was a lot of activity around the connectivity question. You know, what parts of the town, you know, how badly is the Ash Street, the Main Street intersection broken?
Oh, okay.
But it was a very good... active discussion, you know, a lot of people there.
Yeah, we had about 40 to 50 people there. MAPC facilitated the conversation. We broke it out into discussion groups, sort of the World Cafe style. We had a station on connectivity, urban design, focusing on sort of the urban design work that they're doing for Priority Development Area 3, which is the area behind RMLD. We also had a station on development scenarios, sort of looking at how MAPC is doing their modeling and what the potential is for the sites that we've called out for priority development. So we had a good crowd at that station. We also had a station on the market analysis where folks had the opportunity to provide feedback on how they think we should market Reading, how to get retailers and commercial and office tenants in Reading, as well as just answer any questions that they had about the market analysis. So right now, MAPC, we have expanded the time frame. We wanted to do additional outreach, add another public forum, just because of the level of engagement we're getting. So we've actually added another public meeting in September, so you all are certainly welcome to attend that. And the plan will be ultimately presented to the Board of Selectmen sometime in November. We do plan on getting an actual draft document, which I will be distributing to various boards, Board of Selectmen and the CPDC, so there will be sort of a comment period. And I think at that time, we'll want to set some time on the agenda to provide any feedback collectively as a board.
Good. Yep.
Development. We have Bunratty. They're still finishing up what they need to do to open. I know it's been a long road for them, but hopefully within the next couple weeks we'll see that project come to a conclusion and open their doors.
Well, Perfectos is, I mean, the building is actually taking shape visibly.
Yes.
And there's equipment in the property across the street, the Getty station. So the Pizza World is stepping in.
Oh, good. I haven't been over there.
Yeah. And I have not driven by, but Jean has mentioned, because she drives down the way, that Dr. Raven's office is looking really great. The suggestions from the board really made an improvement with the sea of asphalt that he had. So we're going to hopefully get some photos of that and really try to use that as a good example of implementing our South Main Street design best practices, but beyond just South Main Street. So if you have a chance, drive by that. She says it looks really, really great. A lot of people have been asking about the Artist Senior Living project that was at the Eric's Greenhouse. They are preparing their documentation for the building permit, so that is coming. They're an out-of-state architect, so they're working on getting all the ducks in a row, working with their local architect that will be submitting for that. So it's still coming if anybody asks you. I know I've gotten a lot of inquiries on it. The project's still moving forward. So.
Do we have any storm clouds about the Doucette moving and storage property?
Storm clouds.
Then.
Yes.
guessing when things might arrive.
We have not, we have submitted, you know, our comment letter back. All the documentation for the 240Bs is available on the website, including the town's comment letter back as part of that 30-day initial comment period. So you can see what we have sent back to them. The initial proposal at Doucette Storage, there was a lot of pushback on that. There was some discussion at the economic development plan last week about it. It is a very, very dense development, 4 stories in height, I think it's 65 feet tall, 77 units. So we have not heard back as far as the eligibility from Mass Housing on that project or the other one yet. I anticipate that's probably coming soon. But we have, you know, heard a lot of comments from the neighbors so far on that, on the one downtown.
But we don't have any idea when it'll come to us, or if it will, or
it will bypass CPDC, but we will be seeking comments from CPDC as part of the submission to the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things where they're exempt from zoning, so but I think in the past CPDC's input has been solicited.
Okay.
Those types of proposals.
All right.
Okay.
Good?
Yeah.
All right. We'll get back. Next on the agenda, we've got a minor modification request of the site plan review and certificate of appropriateness, 530 Main Street, Biltmore and Main, currently Grumpy's Ale House. So, Jesse, do you want to give a
Sure. So, my understanding of the project is the property is under new ownership. The concept is changing. Currently, it's Grumpy's Ale House. It's going to go to Biltmore and Main. They've submitted some floor plans. They'll be doing some interior, new furniture layout, a new fireplace, some mostly cosmetic work. They are also proposing some exterior improvements related to signage and a facade treatment. You know, I had a number of questions about the proposal. I had sent comments to the architect, and I'm assuming that they'll be able to address those this evening. So I will just hand it off to the applicant.
Brad Latham, attorney for the applicant. The poll is going to make a presentation. Mostly it just deals with signage in a substantive sense. Biltmore has another facility that you saw in Boston Globe, Boston Sunday Globe magazine, restaurants to attend. They have one in Newton, Little Falls, that is recommended to get Biltmore. So that's the quality that we're going to see as far as the change that takes place on the site itself. And as Jesse said, there's no real substantive change. It's staying as a restaurant, same scale of use, same patio area, all that is staying the same. There'll be some dressing up of the facade of the building. And then some signage. So I'm going to ask the caller if she gives you more details.
Great. Thanks.
Do you want me to pull up the existing plan, or how would you like to? This is the proposed.
Yeah.
This is existing, right?
So, and I guess really the, one thing to note is that the, as their designer, what I'm trying to do is reuse the existing furniture. This isn't exactly what's there. So what is the main difference is that there's bank out there already. Here, 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 and here. So those exist, which I'm keeping. Because they're expensive. I'm going to reupholster them, but I'm going to keep them. Right now this is 2 four-tops. And so I was just adding banquette there and changing that a little bit, but it's the same number of seats. And here, same thing, like I'm going to change this to a communal table, but it's the same number of seats. Here I was proposing that we're, you know, if you've been in there, it's kind of it isn't like this. It's freestanding tables right now. And it's kind of bland, I guess is our word for it. It's not appealing to sit in the way it is. So we were talking about doing two-sided fireplace with TVs above and dividing this, because all of their other spaces right now have a private dining room. And we're also going to use this patio, which I don't think has been well used in the past. So we're going to do this better landscaping, newer, fix the fence that got damaged in the winter, basically. We're going to dress this up and make this look really pretty.
Two winters ago, by the way. if anyone's keeping track.
So, and the rest is just finishes. We did the Biltmore in Newton over Thanksgiving. They also own Local 149 in Southie. So we're doing another one in Alston, and it's the same owners, kind of the same concept, but not identical. Each space is a neighborhood place and has its own personality, which we don't think all of the current finishes kind of lend itself to. So finish changes, new flooring, paint, some walls, bathrooms. We're going to make them more attractive, we think. Not dramatically changing it, but he wants it to look like a new space that doesn't look like Rumpy's anymore.
What is the concept?
The concept is it's a neighborhood, gathering restaurant bar. They have a really good menu. The food is kind of the concept, but the owner is also kind of an eclectic art collector. So he has these giant warehouses filled with furniture and artwork and stuff. So, he likes to sort of show those things off in his spaces. So all the other spaces, if you've been to any of them, it's, it's very much about the artwork. It's very much about the feeling that you get when you're in the space. I think there's not enough going on in here compared to his other spaces, I guess I would say, is the thing it's missing. It's kind of a little bit more generic. There's not a lot of personality right now, so we're adding that to it.
Do you want to just walk us maybe through the signage?
Yeah.
So Local 149 is the space in South Boston, in Southie. So this lettering and this wood is one of the things that we're going to try to keep on all of our spaces. We don't have it at the Biltmore in Newton because it's the oldest and it just doesn't call for it. But this has it. The Alston space is going to have it. We want it here as well, so that those three locations at least are tied together visually in some way. It really, works on this building because of how it already is. It looks good. We think it'll work. And I think one of the questions was, were these letters, are they internally lit? No, they're just halo lit. So they're pinned off the face and they're halo lit. And then with this you said no to, right?
I didn't say no, but you are allowed two signs.
Okay.
So,
I think
you have
what
three.
We removed it because we want the blade sign.
Okay.
So that we want, and that's staying. This is off. So that we do want.
Where's the main entrance? That.
So that there's two doors on the front. So we kind of consider, because the parking is over here, this is the main entrance right now.
Yep.
We're considering, dressing this up a little bit more so that this could become a better entrance with the host stand, and then you go directly to the patio. So that's something we're talking about with the owner of, what's better to do, what works better for the space. But we may like that idea of kind of using this more. Right now, no one goes in it. But the patio is not open right now either. So this is the door, but this is all, that's the parking. So I think everyone just automatically goes to here. We're going to put the blade sign there. So I would still call this the main entrance.
Okay.
Maybe a seasonal thing.
We're kind of thinking, right. Yeah, I think it's just, the natural way people are using this space. This seems, you know, as you're driving up the road, that's what you see, and that's the parking lot. So I think that's why, you know, most people go there. But when this is great and looks beautiful, I think people might, you can park a couple space, you know, there's a couple good spots if you get them, then you might go to this door.
Anything else?
No. What other questions do we have?
We can certainly, Jeff, if you want to open it up to the board.
Sure.
Questions. Yeah. I mean, I did provide a memo. I don't know if you want to work off of that.
What page?
Page 99.
So lighting along the... what do you call that? The sign band, the facade, the...
Right, so currently, and I think, that, I mean, in general, when you walk by too, and what this doesn't really show is that there's big trees in front of
right,
there.
Right,
and there's goosenecks all along the front
yeah.
with the grumpy O'Doyle's. It's not that visible. And, you know, the goosenecks don't really work for our concept.
Nor do they do much.
They don't really do
anything.
Much. And I don't think it's attractive. So this is what it is right now, and it has all those, you can't really see them, there's a ton of goosenecks. Now these trees are huge and full and blocking a lot of that. So we're still, I think in the other drawing the sign was here, and we did a revision where we moved it to where it is now because of that reason. So
away from the tree.
Yeah, we moved
yeah.
it back over because there's a tree in front of it right now.
So where Grumpy's is.
Yeah, the goosenecks don't really fit our look.
Right.
The halo and just plain fit what we want to
right.
do.
I'm not, I wasn't implying, suggesting that you have them. I just wanted to make sure that
yeah, we
we're on the
them.
same page. And then no lighting associated with the blade sign. I mean, the place is fairly, there's lighting along the sidewalk. I'm not sure you need lighting, but I just wanted to.
Yeah, so it's blade, I mean, in this one we have it as blade sign is not internally illuminated, will be externally illuminated by goosenecks lighting or similar. So what we've done a lot is, it's like a, you know, it's a smaller little pin light that shines onto it from both sides so you can see it. But it is not internally illuminated.
So we didn't get a we didn't get that, did we?
Do a night. We have copies, right?
Yeah, this revision just
it.
Came
out yeah.
today.
You just gave it to us at like 4.
Oh.
I think that's a pretty good rendering.
Jesse, I think I like your idea. Do we want to go through your list of questions?
Sure.
So that's on page 99 of our packet. So the first one is about the number of signs for the property, and I think we've had that answered, that there's going to be two, and that mural, I'll call it a mural, the wall sign,
yeah.
we're not going to have that. Will the channel letters be illuminated? I think you answered that as well.
Correct.
Just halo lighting.
Halo lighting, not internally illuminated.
Okay. And then the gooseneck lights along the
Sorry.
Existing facade?
We're going to take those out.
All of them are going to be taken down. Okay.
So with the new facade treatment, will those holes be hidden or will they be filled?
I think they're on top of the building right now. I think they gooseneck over. But if not, if they're surface on, then we're putting that new wood anyways.
Okay.
That's getting recovered.
We've had situations where that's come up where we take.
They don't cover them.
Well, we want to know how it's going to either blend with.
Yeah,
the
so
spot,
I would say it's
yeah.
either gonna if they're surface mounted, they're gonna be removed, and then that's gonna be new wood.
Okay.
I kind of think that they're their roof deck mounted, so they would just get some kind of cap on them.
Speaking for the contractor too, we'll cut cap and remove all the wiring, so there'll be no wiring there at all. And we'll fill the holes, so you won't have any issues.
Okay.
Number four, so I think we have that addressed regarding the light source, if the light source is visible for signage, and I don't think that's going to be the case here.
We don't have that as
yeah.
an issue.
What is the length of this wall? The size of the sign is determined on the length of the wall it is to be located.
So if we're eliminating that sign, that's
yeah.
not
oh,
okay.
Are we, okay, I'm
yeah.
sorry. Yep.
That was for that side, then.
Yeah.
So we're not doing it.
Is the blade sign illuminated in any way? We've got that answer.
Front lit.
Yep.
We do have a clarification on number 7. The limit is actually feet square feet, not 4 square feet, and they show that they meet that on the revised 1C, so we're good.
Okay. All right. So that's everything on the signage, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone on the board have any other questions on the signage? Okay.
Just a complete reversal. Would anybody be opposed to that light sign being internally illuminated? Just the letters?
No, I think that was a result, perhaps, of Dylan's understanding of the bylaws. Again, like we weren't.
Right.
This was not allowed to be backlit.
Right, so internally illuminated signs are not allowed in Business B.
Halo is signed.
Halo is, correct.
Right, we had the thing with People's Bank and way back when.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When they misread what Halo meant.
Mm-hmm. Right. So where's the light source going to be?
So we would. It's usually this little tiny one on either side, and it directs, you know, off the wall. Onto it. So they're really little, and they're wall mounted. We've done them in different locations, but you know, like maybe 18 to 24 inches away, and it'll be front lit.
And you'll see that light because you're coming outside.
Yeah.
So at some point, the light behind the blade sign will be, you know, your proportion will be lower than the sign. That's why I was wondering if the B&M or Halo.
So who decides that? And is that an exception to the rule that you would let us
Halo
do?
Illuminated would be allowed.
So do the B&M
mm-hmm.
if we want to?
Halo
so
illumination is just
because you see that sign from down the street.
Yeah.
Okay. So does the so are you saying the B&M can be lit from the inside, or that has to be cut out and halo lit?
I would put the letters on top of the board.
And halo light them. Okay.
That's what I would suggest. I mean,
just similarly to how you're doing the Biltmore,
yeah.
the wall sign.
Okay. So I will talk to Dylan about that. And
yeah, we can.
I like that idea.
I just think it's going to be.
Yeah.
It'll be really visible from the distance, but it'll still be subtle because it's the halo light.
Okay. I'll talk to him about that.
Yeah. No, I like that.
Well,
it's
a good idea.
The wonders of LEDs.
yeah, that'll be a nice
look.
Okay.
Okay. Any other comments on the signage? Okay. So if we continue down the list, these are more as it relates to the site plan itself. Question 8, plan sheet EX1, what is the existing seat count? Do you happen to have the information?
I don't know what it is, but it is not changing. And this has already gone through the Board of Selectmen and their liquor license approval.
So the plan that they had approved is different than what is shown here.
That exists now?
Mm-hmm.
What's the count that you have now?
There was no count on that plan either.
Oh, okay. All right. I know the 160 was approved.
The building inspector will want something from the architect.
Yeah, we'll clarify that. I believe the existing occupancy of the building itself is 160 with 40 on the patio. And obviously we know that we can't exceed the 15% at the bar, so
yeah.
As we, we'll clarify that for the building permit.
Yeah, so.
And occupancy.
This.
Plumbing dry, so the 180.
180 for the
for the fixture count.
Okay.
That's not seating though, that's occupancy, right?
Well, the original
that includes employees.
Yeah, the plan.
The occupancy is.
Yeah, we'll clarify it. The what the plumbing drawings are saying is that the toilet fixture count can support that many, right? So we'll clarify what Nicole, what financial layouts, what the seating count is, and what the total occupancy is based on what the board of selectmen approved but based on the plumbing fixtures, if the board of selectmen approved 160, we're at 180, that's what we're gonna be.
Page 105 of the packet, we've got the original.
Yes, I think probably what seems to have happened is that this was on file and the previous owner changed the furniture perhaps without any approval and just did it. So now, you know, I'm trying to work with what's there, existing, which doesn't match this.
Yeah, because when it first opened up, that center section where it shows all the
That was there.
And then they took it out.
I think I'm just gonna have to work with James to if there is more here than we can have, but we already own it. What do we do about that?
I think currently at the bar itself, the seating count is 23, I think it's 23. So that's what the occupancy can support based on your 15% bylaw. So then we'll just adjust the rest accordingly.
Yeah. So we'll just want, you know, a plan, the floor plan showing the seat count.
It says 175.
And I think that
right.
will
yeah.
take care of it.
Okay. And we're on that.
Yeah.
And then obviously the occupancy load relates
Absolutely.
To the building code
yeah.
and use code requirements. So, you know, that information will be needed at that point.
Right.
Okay. The next one, we've discussed the removal for the gooseneck lights. I think the next one will come out in what was just described as far as what are the seat counts for the various dining areas.
Mm-hmm.
What is the occupancy load for the building? Will that come out in?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It'll all be part of that same set.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Looks like this is just a comment. The fire department will review the proposed fireplace and a permit is required. How will the banquet seats interact with the storefront windows? Will the back of the booths be visible?
So again, those are already existing. They're not proposed as new, they are there. And actually they don't, the sill is at the same height approximately. So they don't, I don't believe they block the windows currently, but it's also an existing condition, they're already there.
Okay.
We can see right now what it looks like.
Sure, sure.
Somebody wants to look at it.
Okay.
Yeah, and then I have to look at that again. I can't remember.
I don't believe that they blocked the window.
Yeah, I kind of feel like they don't block it already.
I think you're right.
But they are fully upholstered on the backside. Anyways, they're freestanding. But I'm pretty sure the sill is at the top of the banquette.
Right.
From what I remember.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. So yeah, I'm pretty it does seem like that is right at the sill level.
Okay.
We're just probably changing the color of the fabric, that's it.
Number 14, not necessarily for us, I would say, but what is the status of the liquor license?
That's approved and sent to the agency.
Okay. Okay, next one we've already dealt with, two signs versus three. The signage plan sheet 1B and elevation drawing A4 are not consistent. Is that still?
It'll go from the signage package. Our drawing, the A4, which is the architectural, was more of a placeholder until the sign was designed.
Oh, I see, okay.
So now that it is, it'll go off of the signage package.
Okay.
And we'll adjust our drawings accordingly anyway.
Gotcha, okay. And then spandrel glass, what is the reasoning behind the use of spandrel glass?
It's probably gonna be deleted. The initial thought process when we met with the owner, based on Nicole's guidance, was as being an art collector, we wanted to create some more interior wall space.
Yeah.
But at this time, it looks like we're not gonna do it. So it'll probably be just deleted. The intention was to use a glass spandrel panel so that from the street it looks like glass. On the interior, you have some more wall space to hang some paintings or something of the like.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But at this time, it looks like it's going to be removed.
Okay. Okay.
Just pay attention to the one facing out so you can see it from the street.
Yeah, I mean, we've determined that we have over 20 areas on the walls. We're artwork, so we're probably toning that down as it is. So we don't really need it in the windows as well. Mm-hmm. I think we're good.
Okay. A few more. Are there any other facade improvements proposed? Any new paint?
So on, there's like little bits of red right now.
Yeah.
These, like right there.
Yep.
So I'm proposing to change that in our blade sign logo, this thing.
Yeah.
I'm going to probably pull out that caramel color and switch it to something more like a stony beigey color as opposed to that red, because I want this cedar, our cedar look color should be up here. And this is going to change to more of a beigey yellow tone to match our logo.
Okay.
So in my process with it, I picked a color that's somewhere in my presentation, and I usually do it with samples, and then we pick it.
Okay. So. Will you want to see that, Jesse?
Yeah, typically we would want to see sort of a color Pantone.
Paint it on the wall, and could you come look at it when it's up there, or do you want to just know the paint color number when I get it?
Yeah.
Right, so I'm going to send that over once I pick it.
Yeah. And so it's going to be all of space, because this whole facade treatment is going to be
wood,
right?
And
that's going to wrap around
this,
to the other sides,
little,
right?
These little bits of red are probably going to go to a...
And then on this, all sides of the building,
color.
Right?
Yep. There's a little bit on the patio right there, and I think a tiny panel on the other side of the parking lot.
Yeah, so just a
I'll
sample
just
the of
the
information.
Okay.
Are there any proposed changes to the kitchen?
No. Not that I know. We haven't discussed changing any equipment that I know of, so I'll double check
okay.
with the owners, but we haven't talked about that at all.
Okay. Just a comment, the fire department will be required to sign off on the plans. It is recommended the applicant meet with the building inspector to determine any additional building permit requirements. And then, this is a good question. Are there any proposed changes to the landscaping?
I mean, the patio is going to get more attractive, I would say. So there's rose bushes right now that are not that attractive. So I would say that, I mean, we're going to improve on the landscaping because it's pretty rough right now.
Mm-hmm.
So the patio is going to look a lot nicer. So if we need to do a better plan of what those
we haven't done a detailed landscape plan,
right.
But we can if the board.
If we need that, we can
I'm
put it together.
Can you, Jesse? Can you, move over and can you see what the patio? Yeah, you can't really see in there.
So there's the fence, which is a little mangled right now.
So the really the only issue that came out before when this was approved was related to the, I think they're arborvitae or something like that,
yep.
Up on the top of the wall.
Right.
Do you guys remember what that whole...
There was some back and forth with the retaining wall next to the patio as to whether the plan showed one variety of plantings and the result was something substantially different. For what I remember as being a good reason.
Yeah.
And it was something that they negotiated with the property owner facing the street behind. I don't remember the detail. But it's the handling of that wall and the screening, if you will, from between the patio and the a abutter.
Yeah, so, yeah, so I would just be cautious about, or involve your neighbor with those plantings up on top of the wall.
From memory, the plantings that are there now are a type of abavite, and those ones aren't in bad shape. I think we could actually leave those and dress it up with some mulch and some ground cover in between.
Right.
And then again, dress up the wall and the street edge.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there's the, I've never quite been sure, there's access, there's the parking area in the rear from the street behind,
mm-hmm.
and access into the second floor of the
really?
Building.
Huh. I wasn't aware.
And it's, I've never seen the, a plan, the, what is, what's the street behind there?
Ash Street.
They never used it commercially, so it was never really part of the...
Well, it's been used, I mean, typically as staff parking,
yeah.
and there's also the storage and so forth up there.
Oh, like a little second parking lot on that side, and they can go on the
yeah.
second floor?
I mean, I presume that it's the same property owner.
Yeah.
Okay. Just from a matter of completeness, because don't forget that this particular building actually has frontage.
Sure, we can include that and document it just for as a matter of record
yeah.
in our drawings to show you what's there. And
yeah, that's also the part of the exemption from loading space.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, personally, in terms of landscaping, I don't think, I guess I wouldn't want to necessarily see anything more refined. From a site, my take is from a site plan perspective, the screening and the issues related to those arborvitae up on top of the wall, that was really the site plan issue. The rest of it is making sure that you have a good space that's your space. I mean, I you're not going to put
promise
in,
it'll be attractive.
Yeah,
it'll look good, okay?
You're not going to put
in.
Yeah, so.
Right. Yeah, no, I agree. That's fine. All right. Any other questions about the site plan itself? We want to take a look at the decision. So we can get rid of the second condition if the spandrel glass is being eliminated.
Are we actually, is that the plan or?
Yeah, we can take that out.
So will your plans to the building inspector show?
It'll just show no change. We'll delete
yeah,
that note and the shading, and it'll just remain as it is. Those windows, they'll remain exactly as they are.
So do we want to keep something in the decision related to that effect?
Yeah, that's fine.
No changes to the glass door.
I can just put a cloud on it. Clarity.
That really is one of the best features of this building. Is the
yeah, it does have the nice windows.
And we said a condition regarding the color of the
yeah,
exterior.
Color
yeah.
To you.
Yeah. Or right. Jesse. Good.
Yep.
Nick, anything else? Karen? Dave?
Do we want to modify this, I'm sorry, the changes to the exterior patio, maybe modify that to
Oh, yeah.
Improvement to the landscaping?
Yeah.
Applicants proposing improvements to the landscaped patio, to the patio area?
Yeah, kind of merge 4 and 5 into one.
Yeah, that's actually true. Okay.
Yep.
Improvements to landscaping, improvements to the fence.
Yeah.
What was that, Nick? Landscaping?
And repairs to the fence. Right, the fence is damaged.
Correct.
And if that beautiful highway sign that got put in the middle of the patio happened to disappear,
yeah.
I'm not sure anyone would care.
So, Jeff,
you
did pick the color?
Yeah,
I
think so,
put
yeah.
that in here for now, and then it's going to be close to this, probably.
You can just...
Just want me to email it to you after?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
So which order do we want to do this in?
I think we're good on the minor mod. Do you want to approve that or do we want to jump to the sign first? Let's knock the...
We do want to... Sorry, another... Oh, wait. I think
oh,
we're
I'm
good.
Sorry.
Total number of seats not... Okay, we're good with that. Go ahead.
Do you want to jump to the sign?
Well, or...
It doesn't matter. Yeah, just... Go ahead, that's fine.
Move that the CPDC approve the minor modifications for the proposed tenant change at 530 Main Street to be known as Biltmore and Main.
All those in favor? All right. So the only change to the signage plan as it relates to the latest copy that you provided is how it's going to be illuminated, right?
We just decided we're going to do the B&M halo lit.
Yeah, that's condition number 3, I think.
And you have the sign being centered right on the front of the building?
Yeah.
Yeah, and the location moved over.
I'm just curious, I just noticed, these are kind of, it's probably the printer, but which color is it closer to? Is it that brown or that kind of?
It's in between.
It's in between, all right.
Yeah, it is definitely in between. So the first one is, it's too red.
Mm-hmm.
That the redding and the established, those are more the caramely color.
Okay.
Like a camely caramel color. So I would say that's too bright. And then the last sign is dark. It's that looks to me like it's chocolate.
Yeah.
It's not quite that color either.
Okay.
Just get Jesse a sample or an Ariel or something.
Yeah. Okay, we can do that. I think when I emailed that it came out much better than this actual printout. So I'll look at that, and then we can clarify that. Yeah, so this is my presentation. So you can sort of see it's in between those two. It is a burgundy red, but this paint color is much more caramely.
That's what the redding's going to be in? And
yeah.
Okay.
It's not this brown.
And the blade sign... Mr. said that the limitation is what square footage?
Eight.
Eight square footage.
And we have it at 7.77.
7.77 stone.
Yeah.
Okay.
What's your timeline?
Tomorrow.
Perfect.
As soon as you approve it. So, we want to get started soon.
Okay. Good.
So
it's exciting.
We're gonna be trying to go for permit, and then we haven't ordered everything. Furniture has to go out, so there's a schedule to be put in place. But pretty soon.
Perfect. That's great.
Are we ready?
I think so. Yeah.
Move that the CPDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for the proposed signage at Biltmore and Main at 530 Main Street.
All those in favor?
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank
Thanks,
you.
Folks.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Have a good one. Was that?
Well, in one of these collections of paper, which I think was in the mailing, the minor mod says Chili's sign.
Yeah.
Chili's
yeah.
Restaurant.
We included it, and it was still in draft format, and it got printed. So.
Yeah, I looked at this and
wait a minute.
I know, and I think I sent an email out saying disregard it.
Yeah.
I think it was my email. I'm sorry about that. Oh.
Oh my gosh.
Thanks.
All right, so next up, zoning amendment, review of draft language. We've got the telecommunications bylaw and the aquifer protection. Do you want to just knock out the aquifer protection?
Sure.
And then, I don't know, the telecommunications, we'll get to that, but I counted kind of five major decisions we need to agree on, and maybe we try to tackle two of them tonight. I don't know if we're necessarily going to have the capacity to go through the whole thing.
So, related to the aquifer protection district, since your hard copies were mailed out, we did get a revised copy from town council. I printed a color copy for your desk because he tracked changes to a bold and cross out that I've been working on, because ultimately I think we do want to show a bold and crossed out version. That's what we sort of heard from town meeting, is that they really like to see that. So at some point, once we finalize the language, based on his recommendations, I'll turn that into a bold and cross out. So what he did since the mailing was address some concerns from the town engineer. I do believe I included in your dust packets his memo.
Whose memo, George?
George's memo. I hope I did. If not, I believe I have it on the screen. Maybe I don't. Let me see if I have it. So, here's his comment, his memo. His comments were...
I think we have it.
You think you have it?
Mm-hmm.
Is this it? 134?
134.
Oh, wait, maybe it gets cut off.
It's a memo. I don't think I included it in the dust packet.
Okay.
But we do have it a year up on the board. So some of his concerns related to the language about the stormwater regulations. So he suggested at the end of the word precipitation to use this, the design standards. He wanted to sort of emphasize that because it's the actual design standards were concerned about, not necessarily the stormwater regulations. It's the design standards contained within the regulations that we wanted to point applicants to. The other comment he had was about a section that we were proposing to add in, which was allowing or requiring additional treatment for the removal of nitrogen. And he recommends that this be deleted because it really only provides for that initial treatment and not for recharge. So he made that recommendation. And then lastly, he felt that this provision here was very confusing and wasn't sure what we were trying to get at. In speaking with him, I told him it was a comment that we had regarding underground, like fuel tanks, basically heating fuel tanks in basements, and how do we address that to make sure that it's clear that those are allowed in this district. So we sort of thought we had it squared away with this language, but it just didn't seem clear enough. So what council did on Friday was further revise the language. He took the recommendation from George, the first one regarding the stormwater design standards. He has no problem with that, making that change. So we did that, the design standards. And then he did say that it, you know, we could eliminate this. We may get some pushback from DEP because this is actually in their model bylaw. But it really does not provide that recharge. It's really for treatment. So you know, we certainly could leave it in, but council said, you know, you can leave it out. And then lastly, when it comes to the issue of the underground storage tanks, we did revise it, address it in two ways. So what we did was we added a definition of underground storage tanks, which sort of allows for fuel tanks. It defines underground storage tanks by not including fuel tanks. And then this prohibition would allow fuel tanks and petroleum tanks, propane. So it sort of does it in two ways, addresses the concern in two ways. So we're saying here that underground storage tanks are prohibited with the exception of liquid propane. But then in the definition of underground storage tank, we do not classify heating oil tanks as part of that. So they would, in fact, be allowed by that definition. It's a little confusing.
But they should not be.
Heating oil tanks.
Heating oil should be prohibited in underground storage tank. I mean, that has been true for decades.
You're talking about...
We're talking about not underground.
Underground
should be talking about... in your basement, under grade.
Right.
That's
and that's
what we should be talking
grade,
about.
Yes.
Yes.
Right.
Not
so
underground.
That's why we...
I mean the...
Right.
Right.
Correct. So I included council's email talking about his changes. On page 132.
Yeah, this definition is still not quite there.
Right.
Yes?
Should that not be considered an underground storage tank? It's supposed to be, it says shall not consider and quote underground storage tank, unquote. You consider it indeed. Okay.
Yeah.
Stephen Croft, 137 Pleasant Street, by the way.
What are we looking at?
The
definition for underground storage tank. The,
which is on.
I'm just looking at it right here in the email. Should not be considered ED.
Yeah, okay.
mentioned that here we go, we're defining something in terms of what it's not.
Yeah, we've tried to get away from that. So are we considering revising this definition?
Well, I think we have to.
Yep.
Should you describe it as an above-ground storage tank, or define above-ground storage tank as being a tank that might be located in a cellar, basement, whatever, with all its size visible, and so on and so forth?
That could be below grade.
But below the grade, basically the same text you have in what is not an underground tank.
Well, the simplest thing is to say, you know, what the requirements are for safe storage of liquid petroleum products for normal household use. And then, in addition, say that underground or buried storage tanks for liquid propane are permitted. So basically, there's a set of requirements for safe tanks for home heating oil. I don't know offhand where those descriptions are, but they advertise them when they're trying to sell you new fuel tanks.
Mm-hmm.
And it basically says, you know, if it's in a basement or cellar, situated upon or above the surface of the floor, also it's blah blah blah. I mean, basically that's. Those are the only ones which are permitted. And then in addition, you can put a liquid propane tank and bury it outside if you want to. I grew up in a house with a 1,000-gallon fuel oil tank buried in the front yard, but you can't do that anymore.
So what are we suggesting here? Are we?
Well, when you look at that definition, it doesn't say anything about what an underground tank is. It just talks about what is not.
What is not
an underground tank for this section of the bylaw.
And what does the DEP definition have?
It identifies underground storage tank system facility
beneath the surface of the ground.
10% or more. It says it does not include any of the following tanks, pipes, which any storage tank situated in an underground area, including without limitation a basement, cellar, or mine, drill shaft, or tunnel. If the storage tank is situated above the surface of the floor and all sides are accessible and visible.
The structure of that paragraph is that the definition is the main body, right? There's the definition, and here are the exceptions to it. Whereas ours is one paragraph,
mm-hmm.
which states any underground tank, doesn't tell you what that means, and then just says this, and it's not this. So if we're going to continue to have this, it has to be underground storage tank. We should define what underground storage tank is and then say accept the following, and then that would be pretty much the rest of the body.
527 CMR 9.00.
So discuss the fuel.
Tanks and container regulations.
Is that a part of fuel mass?
That's mass.
Yeah.
I don't know what definitions they might have on mass. Part of Board of Fire Prevention regulations, tanks and containers.
Mm-hmm.
What was wrong with that one?
Well, because mass has different requirements of what's exempted, and I think it's 500 gallons for fuel, home fuel use.
So they did have something in here about fuel oil or tank. They have a definition for tank.
Any underground tank or container more than whatever 90% below the surface of the grade that contains a regulated substance. Any underground tank or container. I don't know if there is the right word, but located more than.
I think it was 10.
Yeah.
10% or more of which is below prevailing grade, yeah.
Why would you have that?
Hmm? To control the height of the thing, I mean, if you got, you know, some
right,
large.
We're talking about aquifer protection, right? The idea is that we don't want the tank to leak.
Right.
So I guess I would say any portion of which is located below the surface of the grate, because then you can't see the leak. You can't see the bottom. If you can't see the belly of the tank, then you can't tell if it's leaking. And so I would try any underground tank or container.
Well.
And underground tank or container. Any portion of which is located below the surface of the river.
Well, I mean, underground is the slippery word.
Well, we just said here that underground is about putting it below the grade. And then there's the exceptions, which is the rest of this, right?
Okay. So we're defining the underground storage tank to be?
To be that first sentence.
Right, okay.
You can't see whether it's leaking in that solution. You can have an above ground storage tank in the aquifer protection district, right? Up on a pedestal, so
mm-hmm.
a propane tank or
right.
a tank.
And do we want to just use that sentence, any of the following?
Yeah, the rest of it was fine. The rest of what we had was fine, as the exception. So put a colon there and then indent the rest of that paragraph. That's whatever it is, one.
Do we want to maybe delete up to... Shall not include...
No, I think you're including all of that.
Okay.
So, colon after include, and
yep.
then put number one in front of provide, and then that will come. We'll get rid of provided.
Yeah.
Yeah.
About storage tanks for compressed air?
It's not a regulated substance.
Okay.
We're worried about contaminating the aquifer, not necessarily about.
Okay, so yeah, the hazardous substance line earlier, that doesn't.
Yeah, I mean, that is part of what you had up before mentioned, how regulated substance. These tanks contain a regulated substance. So you could have an underground water tank if you're doing stormwater collection for irrigation.
Or you get a well for irrigation.
And you pump it to a tank.
Or if it's the working fluid for geothermal or something like this, with non-toxic, blah blah blah.
Yeah, if you had some non-toxic, you had a glycol though, then that would be a regulated substance. That's not a tank. You need to be a tank. It'd be in a loop, like pipes or something. But the lawyer's gonna look at this again, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you could add to it. An underground tank or container holding a regulated substance, a regulated material.
Do we want to say hazardous?
Yeah.
Though, are you in the...
This is still the definition. We're
yeah.
adding a definition.
See, so that what's regulated, I mean, what's in here in the back is what's not allowed is underground storage tanks containing hazardous materials. So the it's still, if it has compressed air in there, it's still an underground storage tank.
Yeah.
It's just not allowed
if it contains storage of liquid hazardous materials and or liquid petroleum products.
What John's saying is that elsewhere in this. It talks about not allowing
hazardous material in
this
that.
This is just a definition of an underground tank.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, so we don't need it in there.
Okay.
So, yeah, it doesn't matter what it contains.
Right.
It's still called
an underground
tank. In terms
of
the definition,
yeah.
Right.
Okay. I notice in the purpose for this area, for this bylaw, we don't talk about the fact that we're actually obligated to maintain the aquifer protection district by our agreement with MWRA. The purpose says
mm-hmm.
that we're doing it to provide water for us, right?
The I think over the years the requirement for it has gone beyond the MWRA agreement.
Well, I'm not saying that's the only purpose. I'm just saying that's one of them. Here it talks about ensuring adequate quality and quantity of drinking water for the residents. We don't drink that water. And if we do, it's actually under boil water. You know, if we start pumping from our wells again, we have to boil that water. So I don't know how safe that is or how good it's going to taste. So people are always getting up in an uproar about this whole thing because they don't like the regulation. It's too restrictive, and we're sort of obligated to do it for a number of reasons, one of which is our agreement to buy water from the MWRA. I'm just wondering whether that should be one of the purposes or if that complicates things in the future if the agreement changes and the bylaw has to be amended.
Well, it wasn't even an agreement, right? It was a consent decree, which is that's not changing, right?
Right.
That is what it is.
We should add that.
I'm not, all of what you say is true, but I'm not sure that item A is in fact correct. It's got... I mean, the purposes of the aquifer protection district are B, C, and D.
Mm.
You know, because as Nick says, I mean, we're not drinking the water. You know, the wells are there basically for emergency use, which is primarily fire hydrants.
Mm-hmm.
You could say something like to maintain an adequate quantity of drinking water. Maybe we just have to ask Ray about that. What the
So it's almost, yeah, I mean, should we delete it?
Delete drinking?
Delete.
What was that?
It's all of our water.
Delete the word drinking. You might still desire your water, firefighting, or whatever other uses to be free of hazardous substances, say petrochemicals, for example. I wouldn't want to sprinkle it.
Yeah, wouldn't that be an interesting
The fact that it tastes bad and you have to boil it first, and you've got the more, I should say, different issue. Or as you say, another purpose is to comply with agreements or maybe
I like the idea of putting that in as part of the purpose, because we continually, every time this comes up, that's the explanation of why we can't get rid of it. So, yeah, it might change, but that's the purpose right now.
And you don't have to like the consent agreement, but it's
Basically, to conform to the terms of the XYZ agreement with DET and the MWRA.
It gets said every time we talk about this.
Right, and do that instead of A.
Yes.
Because B, it says it's the existing and potential sources.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, the rest are legitimate.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It does make sure it's part of the region.
So I can go back to Ray and present him our changes to the definition and the purpose, question about the purpose. Anything else?
Anything else looks good to me.
Yeah.
Yep.
Karen, Nick. You alright with the rest?
Yeah, there was one paragraph that was confusing. I had to read it several times and was wondering whether we should separate it into two, but it's fine.
Sure, we can. Or you can save it for the public forum.
See if anybody else comes.
Okay. Karen, you alright?
Good.
Okay. Okay. So that takes care of that one. Now we've got the telecommunications bylaw. Where'd that go? So, Jesse, like I said when we spoke earlier, I like how you broke this out, kind of the cheat sheet that you gave us. Identified, from what I could tell, five key decisions or five key areas that we need to decide on. Siting preferences, installation type preferences, special permit requirements, height and setbacks, application procedure.
Mm-hmm.
So it's 10:45. And from my perspective, I don't know, maybe one in the first two, siting and installation type preferences. These we should be able to discuss these pretty quickly. I mean, they feel pretty straightforward to me, but
yeah, they seem backwards.
Yeah. So, do we want to decide on these two tonight, or at least, you know, discuss them, debate them, and then save the next three for our next meeting, which I understand is also going to be a crowded agenda? Potentially.
Potentially.
Okay. Yeah.
Throughout the bylaw, he refers to it as Reading. How the improved service to Reading, you know, objectives in Reading. I'm just wondering if that should even say the town of Reading or the town. I don't think it should just say Reading. Throughout the code, he says that. I don't think you say it that way anywhere else.
I think you're right.
The telecommunication code?
Yeah, in that.
Okay. Just going to make a note here.
Any other general comments? Okay, we're looking at the consideration sheet that Jesse put together, the siting preferences. I'll just read it out loud. The CPDC should consider siting preferences. Draft preferences are, and this is what we have to decide. Right now, the first preference would be a site located entirely within the business and industrial zoning districts, so business A, B, and C, and then the industrial zone. Second preference, a site located entirely within an interstate highway right-of-way within the residential S15, 20, 40, or A80 zoning districts. And then the third preference, a site located outside of an interstate highway right-of-way within the residential S15, 20, 40, A40, or A80 zoning districts. So those are the drafts. But that's the draft.
It seems that the third one should be first. Anything along the interstate highway.
The second one.
The second one.
Second one.
A site located within the highway right of way.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, in S15. Yeah.
Now, are we limited to three?
I don't believe so.
At this point, that business B over on the northeast side of the rotary, right where REI is, that's business B, but it potentially has a sliver of highway within it. Sliver of highway right away within that business B. If it did, then I would say we could include business B where it directly abuts.
Sure.
Interstate right away. Right, we want to keep it out of the downtown. Probably want to keep it off of Main Street, unless it's well hidden in a building of some sort.
Should we not consider this as a potential revenue generator for the town?
How would you generate it?
What?
The roof space. $30,000 a year.
Who's the roof? How many roofs are the
municipal buildings, That's what, I think that's what Ray said, that a lot of towns do that.
As the first preference is municipal buildings.
We turned down billboards for $50,000.
Yeah.
We certainly don't want generating the controversy behind the radio tower. For $30,000, forget it. You can collect 20 cents per person for that.
I think it's
not
a
quite. It's like a dollar per person.
Either way.
8,000 households. I think it's 20,000 people.
26,000 people.
20 cents.
So looking at our zoning map, I'm not sure. There might be a portion, depending on where the rotary is, that it'd be close, but it's hard to tell. Business B sort of ends at, this is Line Road. Business B goes to about here, so I'm not sure where the highway layout is here. But
yeah, there's a lot less space up there.
Yeah,
does the highway include the land around the rotary?
Yeah, they.
And that is Mass DOT land.
Yeah, the rotary is there.
Is that considered interstate right of way, or is that considered just Massachusetts Highway interstate?
That would be interstate, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That whole the whole interchange.
Includes that whole interchange.
Yes.
Come out both ways.
Right.
This is where the Cumberland Farms station is, right?
Right.
In here? So it goes.
It's over a little.
And then there's residential here. So there is a. Looks like there might be a residential house in the Business B district.
Oof.
But this here could be a highway layout, but it looks like that's S. 15. in here.
That would be your second preference originally.
Right, now it's our first. I think that's what we said, right?
Within S, yeah.
So you would rather put it in a residential zone that's in the highway, the interstate highway right of way, than put it in one of the business or industrial districts.
So just taking maybe another look at our map.
That's what it says right now. That's how we have it.
Well, the law that we have currently says that it wants to be in the right of way. Period. Now, the interesting spot is the strip south of 128, south of 95, which is industrial, the inaccessible portion of Reading.
So having this as our first preference kind of lines up well with how it's drafted currently.
So the first preference would be located within the interstate right of way, but within one of the residential zones.
Well, I think the tying putting the two of them in the single preference is sort of silly. But
just put it in the right of way, period.
Yeah. Well, without regard for what this underlying zoning was.
Right.
And then do we want the second to be just an industrial zone?
I would think so.
Yeah.
I guess
first preference would be the highway right of way, second would be industrial zone. I mean, because you're allowed to run down the list.
And then would third be business A and business C?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then, it's a good point, Nick. How many preferences can you have?
Well,
I'd probably.
Well, it makes it clear that the residential zones are off
right.
limits, or at least not desirable.
Yeah.
And besides, the bylaw gives us the ability to sort of throw all this out if somebody came and wanted to negotiate putting something on this historic building. Which is not the tallest building in town, maybe the apartment building. But I think that the private building is going to have more opportunity.
Yeah, yeah.
Put it on top of that 40B.
Yeah.
So the fourth preference would be residential?
Right. But I think that we, in passing, we excluded business B from the third preference. Did business A or
Yeah,
C?
We did. So business B we should get rid of. Should that be the fourth preference?
No.
It could be part of that, yeah. It could be part of business B or...
Okay.
You have no preference to going to business B first or going to the residential areas first.
Right.
I prefer not to go there first.
In terms of a tap.
No preference to sticking in business B before residential or residential before business B.
In terms of a tower, there's no difference. Business B is 40 feet wide. I mean, not really, but you know, I mean, there's really no location in business B that wouldn't affect residents.
So it logically groups all residents.
I think, you know, I could actually see someplace in a residential district that would be preferable further away from people than places in business B.
But not so much so that you would make business B your fifth preference.
Right.
Well.
I think from a policy standpoint, I'm not sure that that's a good.
But should we include in our first preference saying interstate highway or other transportation right of way.
Wouldn't that mean
I live on
any roadway?
I live on Pleasant Street.
No, no, no. I was talking about the MBTA, DOT. You know, if it's something where the where we go from two tracks to one, I mean, you could stick a car there.
I'd be much more specific and say railroad, right?
And they have to be 25 feet off of the...
Yeah,
the
there's
rails.
No... Yeah. Well...
You can't put anything within that zone, right? Probably 12 feet off the center line and then the zone of influence off of the...
Right,
the, so
yeah.
25 feet.
Yeah, it's actually... it's it would be 15.
Yeah, it's like the triangle of land that they want to use for access to one general way.
Well, truth of the matter is they can go put up a tower on their property tomorrow. They're a railroad.
Okay.
They can.
What?
They can.
They can,
right.
Yes. Yeah.
So the closest something, the closest would be on top of the depot building, right? Is that part of the railroad right away? Does that belong to Swiss Baker? Is it?
Oh, no,
that's privately
a,
owned
privately
parcel.
Owned. That's not on the right of way.
And historic building, yes.
So this is what
okay.
we're showing.
So we're good with this?
Yep.
I like the idea, though, David.
Okay, good.
How about... how about Camp Curtis Guild? What's that zoned, and can we put a preference...
That's single
there.
Family.
It's S20. Or is it? No, it's S40. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that part of MFDC's? Is that one of those?
It was identified as a locally regional priority, partially priority development, partially preservation because of the wetland, but it's not being evaluated because it's not a regional. Significant area.
That doesn't benefit Reading, really.
What?
Putting it out there. Or we're benefiting Linfield and Wakefield mostly, probably.
Right.
If we're starting to talk about this edge, where Camp Curtis Guild is, you know, we're really not hitting the areas within Reading.
The tower itself.
As a benefit to Reading.
Yeah.
Sort of least beneficial.
In terms of providing that service.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, but if they come out and say they have a gap in, I mean, is it in here that it has to be a benefit to Reading? It just says they have to have a gap
in,
the area. So if they have a gap in
Linfield.
In the Linfield area, sort
and
of
no
down
place,
in that
no
area.
In Linfield, they can put a tower to fill the gap.
What's that?
And no place in Linfield that they can put the tower to fill that gap.
Or, you know, down in that corner by the rotary, to try and push it.
The bylaw says need for service. The applicant must demonstrate the service objectives in Reading that the proposed PWSF will address in whole or in part.
In Reading.
Service
in
to
Reading.
All right.
The first provision.
So then the guild is probably not.
It would be in part.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is sort of a, if there was a giant hole in the middle of Reading,
mm-hmm.
that's the least beneficial for us.
Right.
Yeah. Are we good with these preferences? For now? Okay.
Yeah.
You want to try to tackle the second one? I mean, I looked these over and these seemed pretty logical to me.
For installation types?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't think we mentioned buildings, though. I don't think we say on buildings.
I thought we did. There's co-location
on any structure.
Existing electrical utility infrastructure.
pull the any existing agreement. It's kind of.
It just sounded like all utility elements, not necessarily buildings.
On any existing structure.
By definition, a building is a structure, so I think that also covers, like, what is it, the smokestack at General Way, right?
Should.
Well, the co-location, it says on any existing structure, it says if it already has an antenna on it, you can add one, no matter what it is.
And the water towers.
Like the water tower, yeah.
Right.
Or the smokestack, for that matter.
Mm-hmm. Is your
yeah.
point, though, there should really be, instead of a third preference, which is a site involving a new antenna tower, the third preference should be new installation on an existing structure, co-located or not, before we go allow them to build a new tower?
Not
our third preference would be what, a new location?
Yes.
A new PWSF on any existing structure.
In a new location.
Well,
basically,
we need
somebody,
to say that.
Somebody has to be first.
Yeah.
But isn't that the first one, the first preference? A new PWSF site sharing with existing.
Well, it's a new tower at an existing installation.
Oh, I see. So.
Or a new installation at a site that already has an installation but not co-located. That's the way I read that. Site sharing but not co-location. Co-location is on the same element, right?
Yeah.
Right.
So in this case, the site already has it. There's potentially less controversy about installing another one next to it. Well, I wonder why co-location isn't the first preference.
I would think co-location would be the first.
Yeah, just adding antenna, or whatever they call those pieces,
yeah.
onto the structure that's already
instead
there.
Of building a new tower on the
yeah,
same site.
That would seem to be.
Then what? What's the difference between the first and the second? Site.
The first one has a site that has a tower on it, and you're going to place another tower on that same site.
Okay.
Whereas
yeah.
co-location, you're going to add elements to the existing tower.
Okay. Then yeah, we should swap those.
Okay.
And then the third is a brand new tower on a brand new site.
Okay, but look at the totality of the second preference, which is existing electrical utility infrastructure.
Right, which is good.
That's all good.
So
as part of the first preference?
Yeah, we're saying that we would make the second preference our first preference.
Okay.
So the second preference would be the site sharing?
Yes.
Yeah.
Third is a new tower?
Well, the third was what John was saying. It's a new installation on an existing structure.
Oh, that's right.
Take the wording from PWSF co-location under what's now the first preference.
Yep.
That sub-bullet? Yeah.
This one?
Yeah. It's that. But not co-located, right? locate on any existing structure.
PWA, you know.
How does that look?
PWSF location.
Yeah.
On any existing structure.
A new installation on any existing structure?
Mm-hmm.
To the extent that
yeah.
such is found consistent. So, and then this would be the fourth.
Could we go through them one more time?
So, first preference.
Co-locate on any existing structure. To the extent, okay, that's right.
But it says, are collectively and subordinate to site sharing. We moved site sharing, didn't we?
Yeah.
So that needs to be revised, right?
Right. Equal
just
preference to one another, colon.
Okay.
Co-location, existing electrical utility infrastructure. What's that other implementations?
Allows them to come up with an idea
future.
That we haven't thought of.
It's called the invisible antenna. I mean,
well, it does allow for technology to change and
yeah.
somebody to come up with something.
Just one, does it belong in the second preference or is it
in
kind
the
of
first
its
preference?
I was thinking, is it a standalone? I don't know.
Well, it might be a really good idea that
yeah.
maybe
yeah.
they that we haven't come up with.
Yeah.
Maybe they come up with a way to convert flagpoles into these things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. No, then should we move it up to the
maybe
first?
Maybe we should say something that is alternative that is found by the SPGA to be consistent
yeah.
with the purposes and standards.
That's what it says, right?
Yeah.
That are in keeping with the purpose.
Yeah. It is in the first.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, wait, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a sub.
First.
It's a
yeah.
sub.
Oh, I'm sorry. I threw it in
the
second.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Then we're good.
Second is site sharing of, this is not of highest.
Mm-hmm.
Third is a new installation on any existing structure. Fourth, a new antenna tower. And then the waiver.
And the waiver really gives us all the flexibility we need.
Mm-hmm. That's what
yep.
I mentioned,
yeah.
so.
All right, are we good on this?
Mm. Good to me.
How comfortable, so we do have the website sort of transitioned onto our town website as of today.
Today.
And, mm-hmm.
Nice.
Well, we've been working on it. Caitlin has been working on
so
it.
So exciting that it happened.
I can't take any credit. Caitlin has been awesome.
Good work. That's great.
She downloaded all the material. It took you quite a
yeah, it took
long
a lot.
Time.
It took a lot.
So we have all this information
yeah.
here.
Oh, look, my little
we
table
held the
made
forum
it.
On these sections, and then you know I uploaded section one and commercial communication structures. Are we comfortable putting this version up as well, and put a note saying it's still under review by CPDC?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then aquifer protection.
Same thing.
Okay.
Since you got it.
Public meeting law. I mean, everything's.
They certainly could get a copy of it if they wanted to. I just wanted to make sure comfortable putting it up here. So we can do that.
Post it on Twitter.
140 characters at a time.
All right.
Pictures of the slides I put on my Instagram.
Snapchat.
I don't even know how to use any of that stuff.
All right, so good. So we've got three more chunks of the telecommunications bylaw that we'll table until our next meeting?
Sure.
Okay.
So just on page 115, I have the schedule. So we did have, you know, a pretty aggressive schedule to try and get the public hearings done in the summer before, you know, everybody goes back to school in the fall and really try and get ahead of the game this time. So if you guys recall, we added a meeting on the 29th to have the public hearing for the purpose and aquifer protection district.
Yep.
And then on the 13th to hold at a regular meeting our hearing for commercial communication structures. I really think that we should separate at least aquifer protection and telecommunication structures into two separate meetings, because I think they're two controversial topics. So
we'll see who's awake.
So is everybody still clear for the 29th? I do need to post those hearing notices this week if we continue with the schedule.
I'm available.
Good. So we're going to have a meeting on the 22nd and then back the next Monday with the 29th, just for the hearing. So it wouldn't be a full-blown meeting, just the hearing.
Okay, so the 22nd, we are going to continue.
That's a regular CPDC meeting. We'll continue the discussion on telecommunications.
And then the 29th, we'll do purpose and aquifer. And then the 13th, you think we'll be ready for commercial communication structures?
Yeah.
I think we certainly could, if we're going to meet on the 29th, and if we need to add an agenda item to that meeting, we certainly can.
That's true.
So I can throw it on the agenda if we need extra time to review.
Just in case.
Okay.
Right. Okay.
And I'll also put on the agenda for next meeting as well, the aquifer protection. I'll throw this back to Ray, and he'll probably want to forward it back to DEP to see what their final thoughts are. So.
Sounds good. All right. Good. That was good. Now we've got our vote to include the zoning amendments on the November 2015 town meeting.
So on page 114, you have some draft motions.
Move the CPDC recommend inclusion of the proposed amendments to section 1.0 purpose of the Reading zoning bylaw on the warrant for the 2015 November town meeting.
Second.
All those in favor?
Move the CPDC recommend inclusion of the proposed amendments to section 563, commercial communication structures, now called telecommunications bylaw, and associated changes to definitions in section 2.0 and table of uses section 5.3 of the Reading zoning bylaw on the warrant for the 2015 November town meeting.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Move the CPDC recommend inclusion of the proposed amendments to section 10.3, Aquifer Protection District, associated changes to definitions in section 2.0, associated changes to text in section 3.2 zoning map, and associated changes to text in section 3.4.1 the lots in two districts of the Reading zoning bylaw for the warrant or on the warrant for the 2015 November town meeting.
Second. All those in favor? Right. Good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so next up is the PRD zoning amendment workshop. Is this something we need to talk about tonight?
This is just one of those items that we're going to try and, when there's more time on the agenda, get to. This is new. George provided sort of an overview of what his changes are. So take a look at this and the next available agenda where we have more time, I can put it on.
Okay. This is just PRD or is it PRD?
This is
also
just PRD. He does have some comments. You know, where I think he calls out areas that it can be combined.
Yep.
So I think at this point, when you need something to read on the train or an extra time, take a look at, and when you have extra agenda time, I'll put it on there.
Okay. Sounds good. All right, we did the planning updates. Did I see that eCars or whatever it's called now closed down?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're selling the property.
I think Nick called that
That's
one.
Nick's
Yeah, about what?
Yeah, I wish it had happened a year ago. Pizza World could have just taken that building.
You're right.
Been in already.
Yeah.
I just saw something out there. On
yeah,
there.
That's.
Yeah, it was a for sale sign up.
The police chief called me and said there were no cars there, and I, of course, had to make a joke and say, "Did they get stolen?" So he saw the one day the cars were all there, and then just they were gone, and the building has a sign for sale. They never came to us with any express for concern or.
Okay.
So.
I mean, the site is set up. The site is ready to go for whoever wants to take that building. Plenty of parking.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to get good visibility.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice site,
front,
yeah.
Front portion that could be used for outdoor seating if the restaurant did jump in there.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah, they did a nice job in rehabbing that building. I mean, in terms of what
somebody
it used to be.
Somebody could be in there before.
Perfectos, yeah, they're moving along.
Yeah.
Slow, but
one,
they
two,
are.
One, two, four at a time.
Maybe Starbucks will move across the street.
We're working with Bagel World on their issues with the
traffic.
And in speaking with other police chiefs, our chief had indicated in other situations where this has come up, they've actually requested that the property owner go back to the planning board to come up with a sensible solution. So that may be coming before you at some point. They've tried to do everything they can, police enforcement, the board signs up there. It's just becoming an issue that they can't really consistently control and enforce.
So.
They have moved. They do move through people through there faster. It's like highways, though. You get rid of the queue, and more demand just fills in right behind it.
Well,
so.
Sure, I've seen people wait in the drive-through line longer than it takes you to go inside and get what you want.
So there has been concern about how the operation actually is handled from the operation standpoint, and you know, I think that, you know, discussion may try to be made with the property owner to see if they can do anything to improve their efficiency from the inside of the building to getting
some
customers.
Some MBAs in there. It's a case study.
Getting in and
not
getting
out
quicker.
No time.
You know, limit what is available at the drive-through window.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To.
That's also been discussed.
Or eliminate the drive-through.
It's not going to do anything.
E-car site.
because cars are just gonna, cars would just stack up waiting to get in the parking lot. Or even worse, you get kids, because it's all high school kids, like on the weekends, kids parking over across and getting hit, because that's the worst pedestrian mm-hmm. location in town.
What's yeah. the status of our signalized crosswalk at the corner of
man, that was a while ago, right?
Yeah, that hasn't gone anywhere at this point.
Yeah, because didn't someone get hit there?
Yeah.
A little while ago?
That was near, Perfecto.
A little further
yeah.
down, but
it
yeah.
was,
yeah, I mean, it, same general.
They are replacing the signs that are there. They're going to be doing the water main work. It's going to tear up the road. So I think
is
I haven't driven. I haven't driven down South Main. So
yeah, they've started.
You know, so I think it when they get to the point of repaving, that'll be the opportunity to really look into it.
Okay.
So the other thing I wanted to talk about was the modular classrooms. These were the last site plans we received back in early May. And we're meeting with the school department and the engineer and vendor on Wednesday. They're hoping to get us the most recent site plans and architectural drawings. So here is Killam. Let me pull up some maps too. Wait, where's Killam? Oh no.
On the corner of Haverhill and Charles.
Okay. So if we look at the site plan. This area? Is that where the...
Other side.
Yeah.
Yeah, up there, right? That's where it used to be, is what I understand.
Which one? That's what, Killam?
That's
yeah.
Killam,
yeah.
North
Tower? Yeah.
Yeah.
That's on the top right corner.
Yeah.
Right there. Just rotating 90 degrees.
Yeah. So that's Killam. Then we have, what is this one? This one is Joshua Eaton. It's off of Summer, right?
Mm-hmm. There it is.
Yeah, be right where your pointer is right
yeah.
now.
Yeah, I don't understand what that chevron is.
It's a setback line from the property line.
Which they're not really obligated to maintain, they're not required to
yeah.
right.
use stuff, I guess they don't want.
And then we have,
well,
you want to go back to that one?
Yeah.
It's up against the rightmost set of bleachers.
Yeah, see that, see right there, see those little yeah. stairs right below the where her pointer is? Yeah.
This.
Oh.
It's right up on, right up in that area, yeah. Are those bleachers?
Yeah,
they're like
yeah.
cement steps.
It says concrete bleachers.
Right. Okay.
And then we have.
Yeah.
So Turkey Field.
Barrows. That's up.
No, my kids go to Barrows. My daughter's going into kindergarten. She's going to be in one of these.
Which is essentially
yeah.
sort of right in this paved area.
That really
right.
couldn't be a worse spot, in my opinion.
So,
yeah.
what I did want to update the CPDC on this, and that they are moving quickly and they're a little bit behind in their schedule. I think originally we wanted to have them come formally before the CPDC, but considering you know, the nature of the project, and we would feel that we would like to have the CPDC allow us to work any details out through staff. And I wanted to just see how the board felt about that, seeing how their timeline window is getting very, very short and closing quickly for summer, for fall.
As long as the fire chief is okay with it, they're really, on these small sites like that, there's no ideal location at Barrows. Where would you put it?
Yeah.
And these, like I said, we haven't seen the most updated site plan. If they change, I can certainly send them out to the board individually and get comments from you individually, but I don't think they're going to change much from this. They're just going to actually be engineered site plans. These aren't engineered.
Yeah, we certainly don't want to slow them down.
They have been working very closely with the building inspector, the fire chief. You know, we're supposed to be getting the architectural plans tomorrow on them.
As long as fire access is okay, and as long as they're on stable banks, because some at Barrows and Eaton both have slopes on their case.
I mean, I actually spoke to the principal at Barrows about where they're putting it, and she said that the last she heard is they were going to move it up closer to what you were saying, Nick, closer to the slope a little bit. And these are not... What are these from, Jesse?
These are from early May.
All right. So that was probably late April that I spoke to her. So maybe the decision was changed or never really seriously considered.
But that doesn't mean that they were submitted to us.
Yeah.
They could have been drawn. I mean, these were dated in February, but we didn't actually get them until May.
Okay. Yeah, I'd be curious to know what you get tomorrow.
Yeah, I can send them out to the CPDC. So that, I think, concludes the town planner updates.
Okay. Are we okay skipping minutes?
Yep. Unless you just want to approve the two that I reviewed.
So in your desk packets, I do have Nick's reviewed comments.
I looked at 4-6 and I looked at 5-18.
Okay.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of April 6, 2015.
Second.
I actually have a comment on the second page, just asking. Mr. Mayor has stated that they must meet federal law requirements, and it's just unclear what he's talking about.
I wasn't...
For this, the federal law requirements for the personal wireless service facilities. That's the...
Okay.
So, like, the federal...
For the
like
PWSF.
WSF. Okay.
Yeah.
Then you've got another comment. So I think what Ray was saying was that town meeting review of new PRDs and PUDs, eliminating that would be okay?
Yeah.
If the requirement for town meeting review was eliminated, that
right.
would be okay.
Yeah, okay. That makes sense.
Okay.
Okay.
As a
all those in favor?
I had a comment on the 5-18 as well.
Well, we've got something here for the 4-13 public forum.
I didn't look at that.
Well, it's a simple one. Move that we approve the minutes for the public forum held on 13 April 2015.
Second.
The only, I think we ended later than 8. I don't know if that makes a difference. We probably ended around 9.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Alright.
And then we've got the May, did you review the May 18th?
Just May 18th, yeah. Whatever I sent Jesse.
Yep, it's in your packets, 163. And I think, Nick, your comment on page 166, it's the CPDC site plan review rules, guidelines, and regulations. I think it's site plan review guidelines and regulations, yeah.
Move that the CPDC approves the minutes for the meeting of May 18th, 2015, as amended.
Whoops. Second? Okay. All those in favor? Last one?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? All right. Good meeting, folks.